in the second part of the today's event, and I have to present. So I'll start my presentation. So hope I'm visible and audible also. I mean, my slides are visible and I'm audible, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So the today's talk, I am going to talk about multiphase flows, how CFD is used in multiphase flows, and when there is a phase change. Okay. So I just thought of taking this just by discussing some excuse me. Discussing some introductory part of the multiphase flow, and then I'll just talk about some little historical perspective. When did it start, and like that. And then I'll just discuss some of the applications. Many of the applications already been discussed by the many of our speakers, but I'll just rejoin those applications along with some other applications. And we'll just try to understand, or I'll just try to give you the glimpse of the characteristics of the multiphase flow. Okay. How this multiphase flow is very different than the single phase flow. That is very important to understand. And then I'll just show what are the different governing equations that are generally formed for multiphase flows, and what is general philosophy behind formulations of multiphase flows in this governing equation part. Then once I went to this governing equation for multiphase flows, I'll just talk about a multiphase flow where there is an evaporation. One case of phase change is evaporation. So I'll just speak on only evaporation, how the evaporation is modeled, and how this evaporation is brought in into the picture of multiphase flows, what are the requirements of this, and what kind of limitations that may come when you talk about the multiphase flows, and especially spray evaporation. And I'll talk about the basic philosophy which goes into this spray evaporation. That is nothing but a single droplet evaporation model theory. And I'll just talk about just one model considering the single droplet evaporation. And these models are now in modern days used in CFD solvers. Okay, so I'll just talk about what type of models are there and which are basically suited for your CFD calculations. So we'll just pick up one case. We'll show once again the governing equations. Now, how these governing equations got little bit modified in terms of their source terms. Okay, that we'll revisit it again. And once I show the differences that need to be incorporated in the spray evaporation scenario for a multiphase flow, I will show you simply a 1D case, irrespective of any other phenomena to be considered. So importantly, in the sense, the focus will be on a very simple case where I would like to focus more on evaporation model, so that how this evaporation is modeled, incorporated in CFD applications, and the models, I'll show the verification of the model with the analytical solution. Very simple analytical solution was available for this 1D case, and I will conclude my session. Okay, so that is a plan I am trying to go ahead with. Okay, so let us just formally talk about what are multi-phase flows. So many of them may be knowing just by name that may, if there are more than two phases involved, then we can say that it is a multi-phase flow. So simultaneous, but the five flows are simultaneously flowing, and we have a two distinguishable or more than two distinguishable states or phases, and that too above the molecular levels, more than that. Okay, so we are not looking at the molecular level, but above the molecular level, they should have a distinguishable. So solid phase, like solid phase, liquid phase, and gas phase. So if you have in a domain solid and liquid, if you have a domain liquid gas, liquid liquid, solid solid, but different solids. Okay, solid A, solid B, liquid liquid, gas gas, gas gas, different gases also may be combined, gas liquid, all type of combinations can be there, and we can talk about them as a multi-phase flow. So some examples like air bubble in a water. So in this case, your air bubble system becomes a gaseous system and the water bubbles becomes the liquid system. Then you can have a suspended solid particles in air, say for example the dust coming in your room, for example. In those cases, the particles, suspended particles, will act as solid, and the air is a gas. So such flows are multi-phase flows, and also, as I said, they can have a same state, okay, two same state, but different chemical properties. Okay, so in case of a liquid liquid, for example, you can have oil droplets in a water. So such a scenario is also a multi-phase kind of flow. So if there are two phases, then we call it as a two-phase flow. Okay, if there are three phases, we call it as three-phase flow. Likewise, we call it as multi-phase flow. In many of the general cases, more than three-phase flows are rarely, but there can be scenario and they can be tackled in the same way the other flows can be tackled. Okay, now these multi-phase flows are observed in literature, observed in industries, and they found to have a different types of type of nature, you know. So they were found to have a different type of nature. So some scenarios were there, like in one case it has a kind of interface. So this is interface, and separating two fluids, fluid one and fluid two, will have a common interface, and these flows are called as separated flows. But sometimes you may have a fluid one, and in that fluid one you can have a particles of fluid two, you can have a particles of fluid two, like that. So if such a situation is there, then it is called a dispersed flow, because the secondary phase, you can say first one is a primary phase and second is a secondary phase. F2 phase, secondary phase, is dispersed, not, it is dispersed in nature, you know, it is spread everywhere, like that. So that is how we can describe two scenarios. Okay, so these flows were in the nature, and there were things happening, but many of the studies in history of, if you see, those were limited to only single phase flow. Okay, only single phase flow was more studied. flow was mostly studied. And the most of the studies that happen in multiphase flow started after World War II. Okay. So in the beginning, people started giving about the homogeneous mixed model. Okay. And some started calling separated flow models. Okay. In homogeneous mixed model, they assume that if you have a domain and in this domain you have this dispersed particles, then they assume that they are mixed and they all fluid one and fluid two behave as the same. You know, it's like a homogeneously moving with the same velocity like that. So it's like a mixed model. So the changes in the property, in the changes in the properties were thought to be given by the effective properties, some properties relationship. Through this property relationship for, say, your viscosity, for your thermal conductivity, through that they gave the identification of these phases into the world. Here the problem initially, as I said, the viscosity was the major problem. Then the separated flow models were started by Lockhart Martelly. Okay, they essentially postulated that if you have if you know the pressure loss in the fluid one, and if you know the pressure loss in the fluid two, then the total pressure loss can have a relationship between pressure loss in one and pressure loss in two. But such a kind of total pressure loss, if this is relationship is very linear, then we could add this delta P1, delta P2, and we just get total pressure loss. But that is not the case. These are not linear systems, linear things. So many, what they did, they found out some relationship between total pressure loss and pressure loss between the phase one and phase two through experimental correlations. Okay. So those who might have studied little bit about this, they will be knowing there were Martellini, you know, correlations, Lockhart Martelly correlations mostly used. And their results were so good. But what is found that different flow regimes, okay, different flow regimes would need different models. Okay. So their models were not universal kind of. They were regime specific, you know. So after that, people started making flow regime maps. Okay. So people started making flow regime maps, and where in flow regime maps essentially gives you the regime of the flows where your models are, you know, like that you will get maps. So in this region, if you are in this region for particular this value and this value, you will get the, you know, relationship. So these maps were given a lot of importance and they started working on it. Later on, Teitel and Dückler suggested a map, which is again experimentally obtained and based on five non-dimensional group numbers. Okay. So there's certain numbers he started formulating, and he again found out maps. Okay. But to the loss of it, they were not universal. Okay. So limited to certain liquid gas and flows. For instance, if they go for microgravity kind of problems, then their correlations were not of any use. Okay. So all these studies, mostly we're focusing on the experimental parts, and today still even most of the multiphase flow work, it happens morely on in experimental area, and that too getting the pictures of the various flow regimes. Not even it is very difficult to measure the, for example, the flow velocity of individual droplets or individual phases. So such limitations are also there, but there are certain sophisticated techniques, modern techniques, even with that it is possible. Okay. So what scenarios comes in? So I just tried to show with a grid. For example, we generated a grid. So in one grid, we have your fluid one. And in another grid, you have your fluid two. Okay. So there are other classification scenario comes. One scenario is called a dilute spray, or you can say dilute multi or dilute phase flow. Okay. So what does it mean by dilute? If you understand by the name itself, if these dispersed phases are not so large in numbers, okay, if this, for example, droplets, you say, for example, then if they are very less in numbers, then we say that they are dilute. Okay, so their presence may be around 10% to 12% of whatever 100% is there. So if that their occupancy is around 10% to 12%, we say that dilute. And the very characteristics of this dilute nature is that they don't interact. They may be here, but if they even they interact, they may not be affecting the flow more. Okay. And they may not be even affecting each other. Okay. So these two may not be affecting each other, and they may not even be affecting to the fluid one. So dilute sprays are very simple and not so complicated things. But even if you do the multiphase, if you look at a multiphase flow, they are complicated. Dense flows, on the other hand, they are large in, if these droplets of dispersed phase is large in number, okay, then we say that it is a dense, okay, dense, highly dense things. So say on the basis of, for example, number density, for example, if you take this volume, and in this volume you have, suppose, many, many dispersed phases, so that will show the number density. So if number density is more, number of droplets per unit volume are more, then we say that it's a dense. And in such situation, in denser situation, we cannot avoid contact between two particles or droplets, or two dispersed phase, individual dispersed particles. So it is very difficult. So there can be a collision in case of, suppose, they are solid particles, and they can have a strong interaction among themselves. Okay. And not only among themselves, they, since their majority is much more higher, they can also influence, on the other hand, very strongly to the continuous fluid. Okay. So they can strongly affect the continuous flow. So this phase, which we can see by nature itself, there is a continuity in terms of a continuum approximation. Okay. However, if you see the other phase, it looks like not so continuous. So first phase we say continuous phase, and other phase we say dispersed phase. Such a kind of phases or such a kind of flow phenomena we already seen in horizontal pipes, vertical pipes, with different types of flow phenomena, bubble flow, slug kind of flow, churn flow, annular flow. This majorly, these flow phenomena need a judicious use of the model. Say, for example, in a dilute case, for example, dilute cases, best modeling approach is Eulerian. Okay, Eulerian approach is mostly used. Okay, Eulerian for continuous phase and Eulerian for the dispersed phase. However, when you come to just a minute, I just made a lawyer Eulerian Lagrangian. This is dilute. So the particles are very small in number, okay? Lagrangian, just a minute. So particles are very, this is a dilute case. So particles are a very large, they are very small in number. So Lagrangian approach can be used, and they can, their motions can be tracked so that it becomes computationally less intensive. And we can go ahead with that formulation, Eulerian Lagrangian formulation, and solve the dilute flows. When it comes to dense flows, Eulerian Lagrangian is not, Lagrangian approach, if you start to give and start, modeling it, it will be computationally very time consuming. So it is advised that you should go for Eulerian Lagrangian for dilute phase, and dense for denser flows, Eulerian approach can be followed. If you can go, if you can afford that much computational resources, you can even go for a Lagrangian approach, because as discussed by Dr. Rajagopalanji, the Lagrangian approach was having a certain advantages. Okay, it is independent of the grid, so there is no some sort of numerical diffusion. Okay, so if you have, if you do a CFD discretization on the continuous grid, then for a continuous fluid, for example, then you come across with numerical diffusion. Okay, the second order terms will give you the numerical diffusion. Now in this case, there is no grid present in that for the case of dispersed phase, so they are independent of that, so you don't have numerical diffusion problem. Okay, so Eulerian models can be used. So based on the choice and based on the scenarios, you can judiciously select the type of models. Okay, I'll discuss this Eulerian Lagrangian in further in coming. And there are very good texts, which one text I would recommend is for 1D flow. This just talk about 1D flow. Okay, and give you all this Lockhart Martellini and kind of correlations, and then to get another good idea is multiphase flow by Crowe. This is by Wallis, this is by Crowe, and by Ishii. This is one of the good book for modeling of multiphase flows. Okay, we'll see how complicated, I mean, there are certain issues with the modeling, not complicated, but there are certain issues that resolved, and those formulations and details are given in this book. Some computational related things are nicely discussed in this book by Tu and Eho. Okay, so for further, if anything is for further discussions or further digging into the multiphase flow and scenario which I might not have covered and left in between, you can refer in these books. So where do you find multiphase flows? Multiphase flows are ubiquitous in nature. Okay, we see the rainwater that comes. So that thing, you have a dryer, for example. So in that case, spray drying, drying can be a process used. You have a dust formation, environmental flows, where you have a dust particles flowing in case of desert regions with high wind velocity. Such scenarios can be modeled using multiphase flows. You have this injection powder coating system, spray coating system. You have the substrate formation processes. You have this fire suppression. Most of the malls use this fire suppression systems, where sprinkles can be used, and with the fine droplets, the heat of this combusted or fire is taken out, and they were extinguished. Sometimes you can have you would like to have the erection of the cleaning of the tubes, then you can use droplets and this to clean the inner surfaces. You can have a water jet, even this water jet machines. They are also modeled as multiphase flows. You have a combustion system. Suppose you have an injector, for example, then an injector in some combustor chamber, for example, then then you have very complicated scenario, in the sense initially there will be a formation of the waves instability, and that instability will lead to the formation of droplets, and this droplet may evaporate and vaporize, and you know the combustion may happen later. So before combustion happens, you know, in such situations, the vaporization becomes very, very important phenomena, because it's a very slow process, and the liquid properties are very different than the gaseous properties. So the phenomena happens in the liquid region. It takes a lot of time. So if it takes a lot of time, your combustion may not happen, and your flame is moving. So you might have to design your system's length such a way that you get a proper flame here. So that all depend length of the dimensions of the combustor, the combustion efficiency. Again, all this affects because of this droplet vaporization, and that may need even other flows like spray which you take, the asthma spray and these things, blood flows, and many more. You know, you can name many more multiphase flows, and these things have a ubiquitous nature. So, and you can use CFD in understanding this multiphase flow as a research tool and design tool. Those who are in the research R&D activities and designing activities, say for example, I said one example in designing the combustor, you can use the knowledge in this, and you can use it as a design tool. You can even use as a research tools. For example, many of our hands-on sessions were discussing there were some other way of having multiphase flows, and there the problems shown were helping to give some insights. Okay, having seen this wide application of this multiphase flows, these multiphase flows are characteristically very different than the single phase flow. Okay, in case of single phase flow, there is no interface, but in case of multiphase flows, you have an interface, and that interface, that suppose you have this interface is also not constant. At later point of time, this interface might change. At any other point of time, the interface might change. So there is a existence of dynamically changing interface. Then the question comes, how do you model such a kind of flows which will have this dynamically changing interfaces? Also, the properties are very different. And if you have a domain, there are essentially a lot of strong discontinuities in the fluid properties may be observed. Okay, so strong discontinuities in the fluid properties near the interface itself. Here, if you go and zoom near this interface itself, a lot of complicated flow happen. You know, the near this, lot of complicated flow happen. Say, for example, in case of having you have a droplet, for example. So even these droplets are made up of very, very small molecules. And this, when they, for example, evaporate, or if some new droplets forms or something, then there have a some kind of etching of the molecules, and they will form some new, you know, this thing. So some part may go, and that process itself is very complicated at the molecular level. Even the equilibrium conditions like thermal equilibrium, non-equilibrium nature can be observed near the interfaces. Okay, so it has a very complicated interface. That interface is very complicated. And if you consider turbulent flow, then interaction of the eddies, that if they start interacting with this, then again, that interaction causes many much more complications in the flow features. Okay, so they have the exchange. Okay, individual phases itself, they start exchange. They may call these two droplets may at later point of time they become one, you know. Also they may exchange the other properties like momentum, you know, may be transferred to the continuous phase. So all such features, and it has a multi-scale nature. Okay, multi-scale nature you can at least see by different length scales involved in the flow, the time scales involved in the flow, and those are of, you know, multi-nature. Okay, so it shows that the multi-phase flows are somewhat complicated. Okay, they are little complicated than their counterpart of single-phase flow. Single phase flow itself having some other limitations in terms of turbulence modeling and this thing, but apart from that, they are at least easier compared to the multi-phase flow. So a lot of complications are there in the multi-phase flow. Okay, so many of the cases where is in the beginning, and now also people do the lab scale testings. But in some cases, these lab scale models may not give the proper properties which are there in the large scale model. So lab scale model may essentially lose much of the information which is there in actual model. Okay, so the scaling limitations may come, and in such situations, the validated and verified. Okay, so we should focus on validated and verified computational models need to be there. Okay, and with the current computational resources which are available today, it is seems to be a possible and attractive to go for a computational models. Now to derive the equations which are essentially required for CFD to solve, which are nothing but the governing equations of this multiphase flow, the process is little complicated. It is complicated because of existence of dynamically changing interface, significant property changes, complicated flow near the flow, near the interface, exchange between individual phases, multi-scale nature. So how it is done? Okay, so in order to remove the disk, since now we are looking at some continuum modeling. Okay, under continuum assumption modeling of these two flow. Now you see, now the other phase is having a discrete nature. Okay, so other flow is having a discrete nature, and the continuous flow is continuous. Okay, now how to remove this discontinuity in that and bring in into the continuum assumptions? So to characterize discreting properties, an averaging procedure is required. Okay, so to characterize, to bring it into the continuum assumption and to characterize the discrete properties, an averaging procedure is followed, and this averaging procedure is similar to what is done in the case of RANS modeling. Okay, so now here we are not looking for a turbulent flow, but we are looking for how to bring in this discrete nature of the flow into a continuum modeling, and to do that we need to average the discrete phase properties such a way that both the two different phases will come under the purview of continuum assumption. So we have basically some sort of time averaging, space averaging, then ensemble averaging. So this averaging, this averagings where this is over the period of time, this is averaged on the some averaging length, is a volume based on some averaging length, and these are number of different realizations. Okay, so this ensemble average, this is already discussed by Dr. Rao. I'm just touching upon it, and I think you'll get connected to that. So using that, you can get the average equation. So now due to averaging, again, what happens is that some information, that is local information, local gradients between phases lost. Okay, so that is a fact observed, and this need to be supplied. This local information which is lost need to be supplied, and this supplied, to supply this is called as closure relationship, and this closure relationship is obtained through some sort of semi-empirical formulations. So some semi-empirical models are required in order to close this relationship, which is lost by this averaging process, which was due to the local gradients between the phases. Okay, so local instantaneous constants are derived similar to single phase flow. Okay, now what they do now is single fluid, the way we derive the equations for conservation of mass, conservation of momentum, okay, and energy and any other scalar, so-called transport equations. Okay, similar philosophy is used for the single fluid flow, and conservation equations are obtained. Once you obtain the conservation equation, a phase indicator function is introduced, okay, so as to derive the average equations. Okay, so this you know this familiar conservation of mass equations, del rho upon del t, del dot rho k uk, rho u, and k represent the number of phases. So it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. So it depends on the number of phases involved, you have those many equations. If you have two, then you have two conservation equations, okay, depending on the k numbers. Now this is very similar to our single phase kind of fluid flow equation, conservation of mass equation, where now we introduce a phase indicator function. What is this phase indicator function? It says that it is a one, either one or zero. If it is one, if XYZ is in the kth phase at time t, otherwise zero. Okay, so it just identify whether the presence is there or presence is not there. Now if you introduce this and multiply this governing equation by this phase and carry out the averaging, you get finally this is ensembled average kind of equations. Okay, so you get the same but multiplied by the fraction, okay, phase indicator function, which essentially later on we'll say that the fraction, liquid fraction of that phase. Okay, so once we do that, here we get some terms. Okay, these terms are called as interfacial source terms. Okay, interfacial source terms for mass. So whatever the interface is there, there may be some mass exchange, and this mass exchange will have to be supplied here in order to have a conservation of mass there. Okay, now similar equation can be obtained for the momentum. Okay, so this momentum, you see it is similar to what you have seen single phase, but multiplied by the phase indicator function. And you have the pressure gradient, and then the shear stresses, then body forces, and you get this lot of terms. You can get the details of this in the books of Ishii and by Tu. These terms are called as interfacial source terms for momentum. Similarly, for energy equation, we get interfacial source terms for energy. Okay. Now, once you got this, average terms, you see there are certain terms which are averages of products. So there is a product and then average. This product of average of product is a very complicated thing. Okay, so to get over this, the product of averages is favored. Okay, rather than, so to convert this average product averages of the product to product of averages, we have to separate the mean flow from the fluctuating quantities. Okay, similar to time averaging, which we do in case of turbulence modeling. So if you see this ensemble average, and I mean and the mean and the fluctuating quantities, then if you substitute here, and then if you drop the bars and parentheses, you get this nice equations looking similar to the 1D, but multiplied by alpha k, with some source terms. Okay, so this is a source term for mass. Okay, this is a source term for mass, and you can have another terms here. This is a source term for momentum, and for energy, you have this source term for energy. Okay. So, and once you have this source terms, now if you do some linearization, some approximation, if you do approximation of linearization, then you can get the expression for the source terms. So these expressions you can get, and you can have the different source terms involved in it. Suppose drag force due to the kth phase, then the pressure effect, and the in the momentum, like it was energy things. Okay, so once you obtain, substitute, you can obtain these equations and these nice looking equations you can use for the multiphase flows. And if the flow is suppose turbulent, then if the flow is turbulent, then you have to again go for the averaging, and then you have to apply the say Rance modeling if you want to do Rance modeling averaging, or you have to do LES, you have to do the LES averaging, and then you DNS, then you can directly. However, the flows with multiphase flows modeling with LES, DNS are still complicated. Okay, now those were the equations when you have two phases which are which were there, but assume that they are interacting with each other, interpenetrating each other, and interacting with each other such a way that both the phases are continuous. But in another situation, which we said homogeneous flow model, you can have also which we can call like mixture model. There you can assume that this is a mixture, and you can find out the mixture density, mixture velocity, mixture mass or mixture momentum, and mixture energy, and you can solve this mixture equations, where these mixtures can be defined like this: the product of individual sum and product of individual phases, viscosity can be calculated like that. So you see, these variable properties are taken care by these expressions, variable properties, by taking the individual properties and summing them through from correlation and putting it into the mixture phase equation, where mixture velocity is also some sort of average velocity with respect to normalized with respect to this alpha k rho k, and this total enthalpy with respect to the alpha k rho k, and all total of all this. Okay, so these equations are for mixture model. If you want to consider mixture, the mixture models are much more limited than any other two models. So other two models we said, one was that Eulerian model, the first equations we shown for that. If you have a Lagrangian equation, your kth phase equation, that is kth phase equation, suppose it is a continuous phase for k is equals to 1, it will, those equations will remain same. But if you have a dispersed phase with Lagrangian model, then you essentially use the Newton's second law of motion, and you track the you write it for the single the individual particles, all individual particles. So those many equations can be, you know, depend those for those many particles will be solved. And you know that this force is equal to mass into acceleration, so there's a summation of forces. In this, there are many types of forces comes into picture, like drag forces. If the particle is moving in the fluid, it might have to go through the resistance of the flow, some mass, added mass, Bassett history, you know, Magnus forces, they may be acting on them, you know, some lift forces may be acting on the bodies, some body forces also may act, you know, and some buoyancy forces may act, pressure gradient forces. Out of this added mass, Bassett history, and some sense, they are not so observed. But in cases where it is observed, you'll have to model that. But most of the time, drag force, body forces, buoyancy forces, and body forces are majorly observed and they are used. Okay. So again, you have to calculate the mass of the particle. So again, the motion equation for the, I mean, the mass conservation equation for the particle with source term for particle, that particular part, if that particle is evaporating, then the it need to have a source term here. Okay, it will give some source for some mass addition. If it is a source of mass addition, you will have to put it here. If it is not, then it will be a zero. Then the particle's temperature history can be also be obtained through this expression dT with STP is a source term. Okay, so if you solve these equations, you get information related to the mass of the particle, velocity of the particle, temperature of the particle. This information you can obtain through the Lagrangian model. In the Lagrangian model, what they do is they track the individual particles and they track their continuous history, and they again in that you have to find out that there you will have to track their traces. So that is how they for that individual particles, the individual it is tracked along those their paths and their values such as velocities, mass particle, mass of the particle, temperature is calculated. Okay, now once you have these equations, various types of equations, like for this continuum, two phase flow and this mixture phase and this inlet boundary conditions are very important to note. In most of the cases, inlet, outlet and some solid walls will be there. You essentially have a Dirichlet boundary condition at the inlet. For mixture phase also, if you have this component going, then you'll have to specify the value of that, and the other components will be zero. Alpha in case of the two phase flow model, that with Eulerian like kind of this thing, then alpha k at alpha k inlet, you'll have to specify velocity at inlet and other values will be zero. At outlet, all the velocities, this should be V and this should be W. Okay, VW. So this will be taken as Neumann boundary condition, homogeneous Neumann boundary condition, like that. And on solid, for mixture model, you have a no slip condition. Now here the important thing is there. In case of the two fluid model, you have a no slip Dirichlet boundary condition for the continuous variable, but the Neumann boundary condition for the fraction, continuous phase fraction. And for the dispersed phase, there is a slip boundary condition. Okay, so there is no slip boundary condition is not applicable. This is very important to understand. For dispersed phase, there is no slip boundary condition, only slip boundary condition. So at wall, what is the wall velocity? That you have to specify. And alpha at the wall, that will be essentially 1 minus what is alpha c is there. So that is how it is calculated. If your flow is turbulent, then you have to specify k, epsilon and omega at inlet suitably, and at outlet you have the Neumann homogeneous Neumann boundary conditions, and solid wall you have to essentially specify the equations, wall function treatment if you are using k epsilon and k omega kind of, or if you are using LES and other thing, appropriate boundary conditions will have to be mentioned. There are certain issues with the wall boundary conditions which we are not discussed here. In case of some cases, these wall the particles may come and they hit and they may bounce back. Okay, so this elastic, this thick collision and this thing, elastic inelastic collision is very at this moment also there is no coefficient of restitution which is universally universally applicable. So it is still a part of research, it's still going on. Even in case of this nucleate boiling cases also, even some of the models don't work well. Okay, so this is on boundary condition. In finite wall, you can solve these equations using finite volume discretization as discussed by Professor Dalal in the beginning. Solution algorithms remain similar, kind of simple, and its variant. So you solve for, you know, the momentum equations, you calculate pressure, you update the values of pressure and mass fluxes, then you solve for pressure correction equation, and you again correct the mass fluxes, pressure, velocity fields, and again solve these equations till you get. And you solve another additional scalar equations, turbulent quantities, if you have, you update the source terms and then check for convergence and continue till you get some criteria. So it is similar to what for single phase flow. Okay, now come to this spray evaporation scenario. Spray evaporation scenario is very different. There is a primary atomization. Once the jet comes, there is a primary atomization. Initially, the jet instability will happen, and then you get a droplet. As I said, this is called a primary atomization. You get a secondary atomization later on, where rather than here the instability mechanism was there, but here the aerodynamic forces may become very strong. So forces which are because of the other phases, they may become strong and the droplet may start forming. Okay, so those regions, secondary atomization, you may have a dense droplets, and then you may have a dilute droplets later time, and very dilute droplet in the other part of the combustor. Okay, now many of these models you can access from this computational method for multiphase flow, and these books, you know, you can get very good codes, even, you know, that the computer codes, these people's are this is Presserity, these people are giving, these good people are giving very free kind of software, I mean free codes to do DNS, LES of multiphase flow, and you can access those and you can use. So as I said, in such a scenario, you can have Euler-Lagrange, Euler and Euler method, and if you have a turbulent flow, you can go for RANS or LES. And you, if you want to model this breakup, then you can use this wave model, Taylor energy breakup model, Kelvin model. All these are kind of closer models. Okay, these are all observed phenomena. So wave model basically consider the relative velocity between this fluid and the other fluid, and based on that, this wave formation will tell you the droplet time and droplet diameter. Taylor analogy breakup is an analogy between the spring mass system with the droplet kind of system, where you can consider the mass of the droplet kind of system, and you using that analogy you can get the droplet. Kelvin Helmholtz analogy, Taylor model, they essentially consider Kelvin Helmholtz kind of instability and Rayleigh-Taylor instability, and out of this, whichever is the significant kind of instability mechanism for droplet formation, on that basis, the droplet time is calculated and droplet diameter is calculated. There is a stochastic secondary droplet modeling is also available. Now, once you come to spray model, okay, you have, so as I said, if you have this droplet, and now this is suppose evaporating, in the beginning what happens, some molecules will start coming out of it. Okay, so in the process, in the beginning, the molecules will form. So if you look at a molecular level, then this kinematic and dynamic models will be helpful. Okay, so if you use a kinematic Boltzmann kind of equations to resolve this these features along with your evaporation, your kinematic models will be very, if you use a molecular dynamics approach to individually track these particles, then your molecular dynamics models will take care of that. But these models are very complicated, in the sense they are computationally very, very intensive, and the near the field, these effects are not so much intensive in some sense. So hydrodynamic models are most of the time used. So hydrodynamic models do not consider it into account this molecular nature, but simply they assume certain features which are present in the region near this, and based on that the hydrodynamic models are proposed. These hydrodynamic models can be modeled in terms of, suppose you have this droplet, for example. So gas phase. Okay, now when this liquid is there and gas is there, gas is a hot, so it gives some sort of heat. Okay, because of that only this droplet picks up the heat. So initially it will give, it will heat up, this liquid will heat up, and then once it reaches to its boiling point and this thing, then it will start your saturation, then evaporation will happen, and the mass flux will start going out. So you can have a two scenario where and because of this heat transformation, depending on the conductivity of the fluid and depending on the kind of forcing given, either you can have a recirculation inside the droplet or change in temperature in the droplet with space and time. Such scenario may come, you may come across with. Okay, that you cannot leave that possibility there. So in the gas phase, except near thermal thermodynamic critical point, thermal diffusivity is larger in the gas phase. Okay, thermal diffusivity is very large in the gas phase, then it is reasonable to consider quasi-steady models. So what they do is they consider quasi-steady models, and the approximation is widely used in practice. Okay, this quasi-steady approximation. Using this quasi-steady approximation, the models, classical models for gas phases are derived. So, and similarly, liquid phase evaporation models are also present in that. Okay, so what are these models actually? So liquid phase models, essentially they consider either constant droplet temperature model. So they say, they assume that the droplet is at constant temperature, no change in space and no change in time. Okay, space and time, and no recirculation. So which is very simplistic case. Another infinite liquid conductivity model says that droplet temperature constant in space, but it will vary in time because of infinite liquid conductivity. Infinite liquid conductivity, so there is no spatial variation, only temporal variation, and no recirculation. So that another case is there. Okay, so here all the three cases are not there. You have two cases not there. Spherical symmetric case consider as a conduction limit model. Okay, so here the space, the droplet temperature is variable in space and time, but no recirculation is considered. Effective conductivity model considers all. Okay, but rather than considering recirculation, physically what we see as a convective term there, they do not consider recirculation as a convective term. You know that the equation for temperature, you will have such a kind of equations, like if I just write 1D equation, so you will have this type of equations. Okay, so they don't consider this term, but here the K is considered some effective K, and through this they are bringing in this effective conductivity model, through that recirculation is brought in case of this. So we have to model what is happening inside the droplet, and also we have to look at what is coming into the droplet, and based on this calculations only you can get a very good evaporation model which can give you the good evaporation rate and this calculation. Vortex models are stream function vorticity models, and Navier-Stokes equations are pressure primitive variable formulation models, and they are now in practice. These models are not used to do those simulations for individual droplets and things like that, and 2 and 4 models are most widely used, and most widely is very simplistic model is constant temperature, or very this thing second level model is mostly fine, even in Fluent and any other also these models are highly used. Okay, so there is another gas heat-up model. So that is coming like a classical model. Okay, so in this model an explicit assumption made that fluid vapor around the droplet, so here the vapors are assumed to be saturated. What does it So that is the operation rate. What does it mean? That the operation rate is nothing but the fuel diffusion rate, how the fuel are diffusing from the surface of the droplet to the ambient gas. So that assumption is made, and that assumption found to be reasonable in many cases, and the classical model is still being used. However, the Abramson and Siragnano Aho, they came up with they said that there is some layer, the boundary layer formation due to convection, and within that boundary the convective efforts, convective transport due to this droplet motion related to this kind of gas is modeled using kind of film theory. Okay, and they give the expressions. Okay, so once you model all this, Aho and this thing is similar to the Abramson, but the thermal and mass boundary layer thickness are also considered here. Only the velocity, boundary layer was only considered here. There can be another case where all these models were considering the equilibrium near the surface, but there can be non-equilibrium, and on the basis of this Langmuir model, it can be the equations for the gas phase model can be brought in into picture. Okay. So what is observed is that non-equilibrium model again take that the molecular nature somehow through some empirism. Okay, it doesn't solve for the molecules or this thing, but it bring in some empirism and give some model equation, some equation to put in and solve for the operation. But our classical model is still widely used in CFD. And once you have this classical models, what is most important is the nature of the evaporation. Okay, so when the droplet evaporates, it starts decreasing in its diameter, and finally it will get extinguished. So that nature of the decrease in diameter is found to be having a very nice slope, that is called as evaporation rate constant. So suppose you have a d square, then you have an initial diameter square. Then if suppose that constant is this, then you have t, it is decreasing with a constant slope with time, except we having a very small heat up period. Okay, so that d square nature has to be modeled, and if you model that d square nature through these liquid phase models and gas phase model, you get correlations of this nature. Nusselt number is a function of Reynolds and Prandtl number, and Sherwood number as a function of and these correlations can be used in the appropriate models. So say for example, consider a case of spray evaporation. In index notation, you have this source term for mass. It is coming number density into rate of change of that mass of the particle. You have the momentum equation, so drag forces. You have the energy equations. So in energy, you have a sensible heating of the droplet in the beginning. You have a sensible heating of the fuel vapor generated during the evaporation. And one another thing is you have the latent heat of droplet evaporation. Another things you can have in your equation, one is a convection term and another radiation term also can be there. Forced convection term can also be there. And so another, those equations were for a continuous phase, and in case of this is now in a Lagrangian formulation. So for mass of the particle, you have this equation. This equation comes from the conservation of mass and energy, considering that the pressure around the droplet is uniform and uniform. So you do not have to solve, the vapors are not moving at any so there is no momentum, so excluding that, you can get these equations. This kc can be expressed in terms of the some non-dimension. These non-dimension numbers are coming through the correlations, and here this number is called as Spalding's mass transfer number. Okay, Spalding's mass transfer number. And why is this is near the surface, and the mass fraction near the surface, and the mass fraction at the infinity. Because I mean, putting this information, you can get the mass of the particle. Similarly, you can get the from this equation, you can get the velocity of the particle and temperature of the particle. In temperature of the particle, you have this convection term, and you have this latent heat term. Okay, this latent heat term comes into picture. If you have radiation, then you can have a Q radiation here. Radiation now is neglected in this case. And these correlations are very important, and these correlations are mostly used. One of the correlation of that, Range and Marshall. So this is a Range and Marshall's correlation still. But over these models, many other correlations were put up in order to bring in this recirculation and so on and so forth. So one model considering this Range and Marshall kind of model, and defined for infinitely, you know, infinite conductivity using infinite conductivity model, we did a 1D simulation. So in 1D means we have only one droplet at inlet. I just shown 2-3 droplet, but it is one 1D case. It's only having one droplet that is moving in this length. So this problem is solved on Fluent using a 2D grid. And to make this 1D problem, here we have give appropriate boundary conditions here, such a way that the problem becomes 1D. So people can understand, I think, those who are in that area. So these are the some of the conditions given, and at outlet, and boundaries were given, no diffusion, and this in order to make, you know, that you know, symmetry conditions, so that you have 1D flow. And that model was tested, and grid independence test was done for these many cells, and results were produced for a grid. So here you can see a comparison between the analytical results and the Fluent model, for example, and some other models which you know, we did some models, and we tried to compare these models with the mass fraction and droplet history. So our model C5, I'm not giving too much details of this, what is C5 model, sorry for it, but just consider, I mean, just want to show how a droplet evaporation model is modeled and how they are compared. So it shows a very good match with the analytical solution, with the analytical solutions coming from this Bailey and Lin. Okay. So just I'll finish this. I think I'm running out of the time. So multiphase flows were ubiquitous in nature, that found large applications, and empirical correlations are not so universal. So CFD is a, you know, way forward to get the solutions. Then modeling of the flow is very complicated, and if you model, then you get various source terms, and those source terms need to be close, need a closure. Say for example, in case of evaporation, you need a very you know, strong closure, but still they are based on empirical you know, relationships. And if you model these empirical relationships much more better, you can get accurate time of evaporation, and your combustor designs can be improved in that sense. And in most of these cases, one thing I would point out, that whenever the drop, this spray is having many droplets, but essentially what happens is that whenever the research is done, it is done on single droplet evaporation, and a correlation is obtained for a single droplet difference, and that correlation is used on all the droplets in the codes. Okay, so that is a philosophy generally followed in this as a state of the art. So the classical model is one of still now been used, and you can offer some of the other models and incorporate in Fluent, for example, through UDFs, as we did in our cases, and you can, you know, carry forward with that. Okay, I think I'll stop here. I'm sure, sorry, I exceeded my time. Any questions you have? I mean, or yeah, I think I can see some comment from Amulya. Amulya, we can discuss that thing. I have already done work on that, and I can forward you that. Okay, the formulation for that, you will have to do something called as enthalpy porosity formulation under the heading of the you know the two-phase flow modeling. Okay. So that I can share with you, Amulya. Okay. So they model, some models are solidification melting models are like porosity, enthalpy porosity formulation. So porosity formulation, it will come porous terms there, you know, to capture the interface between two phases. If you need that information, I can share with you. Even we did a work on that, and everything is ready with that. You can just get those. Okay, I think we shall proceed. The Rajagopalanji.
Yes, Dr. Dirbude. I'll start my.
I think I'm sorry. I took your time at
this. Sure, no problem. I'll start my presentation in a few seconds. I think you are the presenter. You have to make or give me permission.
Yeah,
to...
I think I have to stop presenting. Sorry. Yeah.
Sure. No problem. Let me know once you can see my screen.
Yeah, it's visible, sir.
Okay. So, good afternoon all to all the participants and the faculty who are present here. So, we will have another session on a practical environmental application that CFD can be used for, namely surface water or shallow water flows. And while we are calling it surface water and shallow water flow, most of this lecture, or in fact all of this lecture, will be concentrated on a particular application of surface water flow. So I'm calling this surface water flow, but this is a picture showing the water or the water flowing onshore from a large water body like a sea, right? This is due to tsunami, right? So this is the tsunami modeling or CFD modeling of tsunami is what we will be talking about in this session and in the hands-on session next. So as you can see, you almost none of us would have heard of what was a tsunami until 2004 when we had the very large earthquake in Indonesia and subsequently a tsunami. But tsunami is basically a phenomena in a very large water body like oceans and seas. And those are called long waves, which travel very fast in the open seas or deep seas. And once they come close to the shore, they very rapidly expand in wave heights and can come onto the land and wash away villages or cities and cause a lot of damage. Now, is there a way to now modeling of tsunamis has been going on for many decades. In fact, the method or one of the methods in our software Tidal, the algorithm was developed in the late 60s or early 70s. So there have been people who have been doing numerical modeling of tsunamis for many, many decades. And it's again become very of great interest in the last 15 to 20 years, and now more people are working on it, including us. So what does modeling of tsunami mean, right? What exactly are we interested in, right? So we will see that in this session. Now, as the title of the session said, surface water flow and shallow water flows, these kind of flows, for example, tsunamis, are modeled numerically by something called shallow water equation. As we have seen over the past few days, different kind of physics are modeled using different governing equations, which are all partial differential equations. So, for example, the session that we just saw, multiphase flow, and the session you saw yesterday with Mr. Chakrapani, the flow was modeled using the Navier-Stokes equation. Right. The session on compressible flow, there was talk of the Euler equations. And yesterday's talk by Dr. Mudhu, Shekhar Mudhu, and Mr. Chakrapani yesterday and today, flow in groundwater is modeled by something called Darcy's equation. And there's another form of the Darcy's equation called the Richards equation, right? Those are, that's valid in certain kind of situation in soil situations. Now, the tsunamis are modeled by something called shallow water equation. Though the name sounds quite different, it is, once you see it, you will see a recognize or become very familiar, or it might seem very familiar to you, right? Now, what are shallow water equations? They describe the flow under a surface at constant pressure. So you can think of it as atmospheric pressure, right? The surface at that constant pressure basically separates two fluids. So for example, air-water interface, right? In water bodies like rivers, lakes, seas, oceans, and so on. Now this, additionally, the surface which is separating the two water or two fluids may be called a free surface, right? And this free surface is the interface is called a free surface when it experiences zero shear stress. Okay. Now, what happens is when let's assume the surface is initially calm and it is flat. When the surface is disturbed, it generates waves. How does it generate waves? The surface tries to come back to equilibrium, and then it disturbs and it might overshoot and correct or overcorrect and disturb the fluid surrounding where it was originally disturbed. Now this again disturbs the neighboring fluid and so on, and the disturbance spreads out from the initial location. Right, so that's a, and this kind of this particular type of wave is called a gravity wave, because typically in for example on Earth, when the surface of a water body is disturbed, it tries to fall back due to the gravitational acceleration or the gravitational force. So for this purpose, this kind of wave is called a gravity wave. Now the term shallow water is a specific term which is used when the wavelength of these waves is at least 20 times greater than the water depth, right? And so when that kind of situation, now this is again, this is a somewhat rule of, like a rule of thumb. For example, when you're doing compressible flows, you might hear someone say the flow is compressible, or you should consider compressible effects when Mach number is greater than 0.3, or under that you can consider it as a subsonic flow and so on, right? So you can consider it incompressible or model it using the incompressible flow equations. Like that, this definition is somewhat vague, but typically for the applications we are interested in, this is very well satisfied. And so what is the wavelength is the distance between two different crests. And typically for the tsunamis, the wavelengths could be between 50 to 100 or even 150 kilometers. In some cases, it might even be more. And the water depth may not be as high. This condition is generally satisfied, and we can usually apply the shallow water equation. Now, tsunamis are also called long waves, and these kind of waves are have some interesting properties. Firstly, their speed is proportional to the square root of the depth, right? So when the when there is a tsunami wave in the middle of the ocean where the water depth may be 5 to 10 kilometers, the wave speed is very high. In fact, the exact wave speed is square root of g times h, right? So where g is the acceleration due to gravity and h is the water depth. So let's say the water depth is 5 kilometers, right? And g is approximately 10 meter per second. So this is 10 into 5,000. Right, so this is square root of 50,000. This is about, I think, what, 220 meters per second, let's say roughly. So this is approximately about 700 to 800 kilometers per hour. So in deep seas, tsunamis can travel at extremely large speeds, right? Like almost like the speed of a very large jet airplane, right? They can travel at 800 kilometers per hour. So that's why in many cases, when the tsunami occurs, we don't have much warning, right? It travels very fast and hits you before the warning can reach you, and or you're able to do much about the warning, right? They also can undergo. Now this is similar to optical waves in air, right? Like optical waves, these waves on oceans and seas can undergo refraction and diffraction, right? So that's why once they approach close to the coast, it appears like the waves are always parallel to the coast, right? So for example, this is a very simplified example here. Let's assume that the water depth offshore changes in this manner. There is at some oblique angle, so at the shallow water, so here the water depth is very small, and in deep waters it's quite deep. So the wave is traveling parallel and quite fast, and once it hits the shallow water, this portion of the wave which hits the shallow water travels a little slow, right? But this portion which is still in the deep water can travel fast. So you can see, if this was traveling parallel to each other, by the time this reaches here, it should have been like this, parallel to each other. But you can see this portion of the wave has traveled a little further, right? Now, again, a little bit of the wave is still in the deep water, and this travels a little farther in the same time, and this only travels a little bit. So you can see the wave automatically bent, and by the time it comes to the coast, if the coast is like this, for example, even though far away from the coast, the waves may be parallel. By the time they come close to the coast, this portion travels slowly, but this portion travels fast, and they bend, and almost take the shape of the coast, right? Now, there are a couple of things, a couple of terms that you will see in any modeling of tsunamis, which is important for our safety and so on. These two terms are called run-up height and inundation length, right? Now, let us assume that the ocean sea level, and this is the initial level, the shore, right? Initial location of the shore. So this is all initially land, right? Now, when tsunami comes in, the water level increases, right? And the water goes on to the land, right? Initially, there was no water on this side, so the water level was initially here. But once the water level rises, the water goes on to the land. And it goes and up to a certain level, depending on the height of the water or the tsunami. Once it reaches the shore, it can travel a certain distance into the land, right? The distance it travels from the initial shore location, the maximum distance it travels, this is called the inundation distance. Okay. At the maximum inundation location, or wherever it has reached furthest, this location, the height of this location above the initial sea level, right? This is called the run-up elevation, right? This is not, now be careful, this is not the water height at this location. You can see at this location, basically the water height is zero. But this is run-up elevation is basically the height above sea level of this point, right? Why is this important? Any place which is at a lower level than this, and in front and between this point and the inundation distance will be affected by the tsunami wave, right? So this these are two important parameters in any tsunami simulation, which is where you're interested in what happens in the land, right? Now, what are the sources of tsunamis, right? One of the major ones, or probably the most important one, are underwater earthquakes, right? These are also called tsunami-genic earthquakes. So these are earthquakes which cause tsunamis to occur, right? The next one is landslides, right? So if there are some mountains next to a coastline, sometimes there could be an earthquake which is not in the sea but on the land, but this could cause some portion of the mountain or hill next to a coast to break and fall into the sea, right? So whenever this happens, so remember initially we said how gravity waves are formed is when the surface is disturbed, it falls back due to gravity and tries to reach equilibrium. So in that manner, when there is a earthquake, so for example, let us say this is the sea level and this is the bottom of the earth, right, or under the sea. Now, when earthquake happens, temporarily this surface might get disturbed like this, right, at this point. So what happens is, exactly over this point, the surface is disturbed in a likewise manner, in an exact manner, right? So nothing happens here. The surface is not disturbed here when the earthquake happens, but maybe just here it is disturbed in this manner. So the water surface is disturbed like this. So what happens then? This water surface tries to fall back and it can go like this. But then once the water surface goes below its initial level, water from here rushes in to fill this level from both sides, right? So you can see this even in your in a bucket at your home or in a bathtub. You try to disturb the surface by dropping some object into the bathtub, for example. The water will quickly, at that point it will be depressed, but the water surrounding it will quickly come in and fill the water. So this is what causes the wave. So once this moves in, again, due to its inertia and momentum, it can't stop, right? So it will come in both directions. and there'll be a wave which spreads out from this point in both directions, right? So this is what is the cause of the initial disturbance. Now this disturbance, like I said, could be caused by an underwater earthquake or a landslide, right? So for example, let us say this is the coast, right? And this coast, there is some mountain here, and after this, some land. So when the earthquake happens, maybe some part of this could fall into the land here and disturb the water surface. And this spreads out in this way, like a wave. So this is one another cause of a tsunami, right? It could also be possible, but thankfully it's not happened in our lifetimes or in many millions of years. Some large meteor could fall from the sky onto the sea surface and disturb it. Now, the tsunami probably is a lesser worry when a meteor falls, because there are a lot of other things which happen which are worse. But it could also, or it will definitely also cause a very large tsunami. So these are some causes for tsunamis. Now, it's also possible that during very, very intense storms or hurricanes, the sea level experiences something called a storm surge. And this could also cause water to come onto the shore. This is not technically called a tsunami, right? This is a storm surge. But this kind of storm surge can also be modeled using shallow water equations.
The formulation of the problem, if it's a tsunami, means the wave levels, waves because of tsunami and because of storm surge, will it be similar, same, or it is different?
Now the storm surge may be somewhat localized, and the storm surge could actually, the wave heights could be much larger, right? Because the tsunami, there are certain other phenomena, like it depends on the wave, the water depth, right? The how the tsunami comes onto the shore is somewhat dictated by the bathymetry near the coast. That is not necessarily issue with storm surges, right? It's not like the waves are traveling at extremely large speeds and get slowed down due to the water depth change. So the way the storm surge, the wave heights in storm surges and tsunamis, they happen due to different phenomena, right? In storm surges and hurricanes, the wave heights are caused by the wind disturbing the water surface. And so there will be some difference in the level, wave height levels you will see in storms and tsunamis. But so I don't know if that answered your question.
Yeah, see, what I wanted to know was, in this case, the disturbances will be because of the wind velocity.
Correct.
Instead of coming in from the formation of the wave, as in tsunami, is coming because of the disturbance in the water.
So, right.
That part you'll be covering, right? You'll be covering that also.
Which part, sir?
The storm surge part also.
Storm surge, no, I will, there's a couple of slides I'll show about storm surges, how it is modeled in our code. We can also, if we have time, we can do a small example where I can show how we model storm surges. But we can certainly talk offline tomorrow or maybe next week. If you have some specific problem in mind how to model storm surges, we can certainly discuss how to model storm surges. It's quite possible using our software Tidal to model these storm surges. Yeah, certainly you can do that.
Miss, what I'm saying here, you can just talk about basics, how it can be modeled using your
software. Sure. I'll talk briefly about how it is modeled in our software. Sure. I'm sure there are the other codes also have similar models for tackling storm surges. Sure. At the end, I'll talk about it.
Okay, thank you.
So those are the basic sources of storm tsunamis, and like I said, storm surge and hurricane surge is a somewhat different phenomenon, but the same equation, these tidal water equations, can be used to model those also. So from this, what I want you to take away is, what are the what's a tsunami, right? And what are various causes for a tsunami, and what is the inundation distance, and what is the run-up height, right? So inundation distance, like I said, is the distance to which the water comes into the land. So this when tsunami warnings are given out, this is one of the parameters that will be mentioned, right? So how exactly they do that, so they'll maybe we can discuss. Okay, so like I said, the governing equations for the for modeling a tsunami are the shallow water equations, consist of three equations primarily. The first is the continuity equation or the mass balance equation. So just like we have the continuity equation for Navier-Stokes flow, Navier-Stokes equations, we have a continuity equation here also, right? And here it is, here the eta is the change in the water surface elevation from an initial datum or initial reference. So like I was saying previously, let's say your bottom is of the water body is like this, and the initial surface is flat like this. Now you can consider this to be the datum, right? You can consider this to be your initial datum, z equals zero, right? I have this picture, right? So this is the bottom surface of the water body, right? This is river bottom or lake bottom or the ocean bottom, right? And this might be quite rough, and this is the surface condition. So the surface need not be flat, it could be some disturbed shape, right? Or this could be your usual daily diurnal tides, right, which have two highs and two lows, right? So this could be the wave condition at some point. So this h is the water surface height of the water at any location above the surface or the bottom surface, right? So this is called the water height or water depth, right? The height of any point in the wave surface above the reference, so in this case the reference datum is here, this is called the wave height, right? Now you can also have the datum at this, at somewhere here. This could be the sea level, so the sea level could be your datum, right? In that case, this will be your wave height, eta, right? It won't be this entire thing, it will be this, right? So the when you solve the equation, this you will have to make sure that you understand exactly what quantity is being solved for, right? So depending on where you put your datum, you will get that the wave height based on that datum, right? So it's typically convenient to put the datum at the sea level, right? And but one thing that happens is the sea level is not one fixed thing, right? It doesn't change daily, but over a period of years or something, the sea level could change. For example, they say the climate change and global warming melts the ice and in the polar regions and causes a general rise in the sea level. It could rise up to maybe a meter or more over the next 70 to 80 years. So what is the sea level now could be different in a few decades. But even on a smaller time scale, the sea level does keep changing, but it changes over a few millimeters or a few centimeters. And there are very precise ways to calculate this using various satellite measurements, right? But we'll assume that there is one sea level, and we will all such computations use that sea level as a data, right? So now you can see this continuity equation looks somewhat similar to the continuity equation you have in the Navier-Stokes equation, but maybe slightly different, right? In your usual continuity equation, you will have the term rho everywhere, right? So, but here you have the wave height eta, but here you have the water depth, right? Now you can see that it's called the instantaneous water depth because as the wave changes, the water height will change. So after some time, the wave could be something like this. So at this particular point, the wave height is maybe slightly, or the water depth is slightly reduced. Now you can see one more item here, right? Or one more term on the right hand side. Now, even though the ocean is a 3D domain, right? You can see only two components of the velocities here, the U and the V. There are only two components. You don't see a W component or the vertical velocity component, right? That's because these shallow water equations are derived by integrating the usual Navier-Stokes continuity equation in the vertical direction, right? In the z direction, right? And the amount of mass that is displaced vertically comes in as a source term or a term on the right hand side. Right. So this is, they call it the vertically integrated amount of mass or mass flux or mass injection rate and so on. Right. Now we'll come to this. So we'll come back to this. Now these are the, you can think of these as the equivalent.
Gopalji, can you check that eta definition, capital H minus small h? So in that sketch, for example.
Okay. I'm sorry, this was based on a different sketch. Capital H is basically the initial water height, initial level of the water, right? For example, this is the initial H, right? And this is the instantaneous, this could be the, small, for example, this could be small h and this could be capital H, right? Small h is the initial level of the water above the data, right? And this is the capital H is the instantaneous depth, right? So h minus h would be the current water depth minus the original water depth gives the wave height, right? I'm sorry, I picked up this figure from another source, so I forgot to check that the notations were consistent. Apologies for that, right? But what is important, notice this small h is a constant thing, right? This is not changing with time, or it changes with space, but it doesn't change with time. So at any particular location, this is the when the sea is calm, that is the water depth above the data. Now, if you consider the sea surface or the sea level to be the datum, this small h will become zero. Okay. Now you can think of these two equations as the momentum equations or the equivalent of momentum equations for the shallow water equations. Again, these are again vertically integrated, so that's why you don't have a third component. So you have your usual transient term, and you have your convective terms, and you have the term due to the pressure gradient. So next, you have some term. This is due to the change in the wave height as a function of time. So this is what is causing the gravity wave. So this is the effect of gravity. So the effect of gravity comes in through this term. So basically what happens is you have a, let's say your calm surface and the water depth. Let's say now the surface is disturbed like this, right? And let's say this is the x direction. Okay, so the amount of the gravitational force experienced by this this thing is proportional to the change or the slope of this slope of the wave at this particular point. And in fact it is negative, the term is negative because that is what is causing it to come back to equilibrium, right? So when it is moved from flat surface to some disturbance, whatever is the slope here, that acts as a negative source to bring it back to the original surface. So this is what is causing most of the tsunami, right? So this term is very, very important. Now you can see a couple of other terms, right? Omega into V and omega into U. This omega comes in due to the rotation of the Earth, and it's this omega is called the Coriolis parameter. You would have seen it in your even in our school days, right? This the rotation of the Earth causes some force or a difference in direction in which the winds rotate in the two hemispheres and so on, right? And this is proportional to sine of the latitude. Okay, now at the equator the latitude is 0 degrees, right? So this omega term is basically zero at the equator, and it slowly increases as you go away from the equator towards both the poles, right? So typically if we are doing a tsunami simulation close to the equator, India is about the southern coast of India is at about 8 degrees, or maybe not 8 degrees, I think close to 10 degrees north latitude, I think. So the Coriolis parameter is not that high even in the southern coast of India, right? So typically we don't, or we neglect this Coriolis parameter unless we are simulating tsunami far away from the equator, maybe towards the poles, right? Or maybe for example in Japan, right? If you are simulating tsunami around Japan, for example, there the latitudes go from about 40-50 degrees to maybe close to 60 degrees or something like that, and the Coriolis parameter plays a very, very important role there. Now this is another term which comes in due to the wind, right? The CW is called the wind coefficient or wind stress coefficient. We were just talking with I guess Dr. Datta there about storm surges. This CW term plays a very important role in that case, right? So the so we will consider that. So if there is a very stiff or in conditions of storm or hurricanes where the wind speeds are sufficient enough to affect the water surface, we will consider these terms at that point. Otherwise, we typically take this to be zero, right? This is something called the comes from the bottom friction, right? Like I said, the bottom of the ocean is not a smooth surface, but it's quite rough, right? So when you do the vertical integration, you'll have to take into account this very, very rough surface. And this is modeled as, so for example, you would have seen it in open channel hydrology, for example, in Dr. Rao's lecture, in rough pipes or in rough channels and so on, you consider the roughness as an important parameter in modeling the flow. So even in tsunamis, this plays a somewhat important role, right? But there is no way to properly measure this. We'll discuss this in a little while. And this SU and SV take into account any other source term, right? Typically, they are not important for tsunamis, but for some other applications, they may be of importance. Now, how are they solved using CFT? Right, I'll just mention this very briefly. We will not go too deep into the numerical methods, but these wave equations are hyperbolic in nature. So, what does that mean? It means they have some preferred direction of information spread. Right. So, you would have heard that, or you would have read in some courses in your undergrad or graduate study. Partial differential equations can be, or second order linear partial differential equations or second order partial differential equations can be classified as elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic. Yeah. So elliptic equations, it's assumed that the information spreads in all directions in at infinite speed, right? For parabolic equations, the information spreads in maybe one direction. There's a two-way transfer of information, and there are some specific techniques to handle parabolic PDEs, and even for elliptic PDEs. Similarly, hyperbolic equations, they have a finite speed of information transfer. And in some specific directions, right? Those are called characteristic directions and characteristic speeds. Any numerical method you use to solve these equations should take into account this nature. The original CFD model was based on staggered grid. I think Dr. Dalal had discussed a little bit about collocated grids and staggered grids on the first day, right? And I had also talked about it briefly in my session on atmospheric dispersion. But basically what happens is you have any cell, right? We are talking about finite volume methods. The wave height or the water depth is calculated at the center of the cell, right? Now let's assume this is the x and this is the y direction. The v velocity or the velocity in the y direction is calculated at the cell faces above and below. And the u velocities are calculated at these points. So the grid is staggered, right? So this is called a staggered grid, right? So this is what the original, one of the original algorithms for shallow water equations used. Right, but one limitation is this particular method can only use structured grids, and in specific, they have, for 2D structured grid, the cells are all quadrilateral cells. Right, now there have been newer methods which have been developed in the last 20 to 30 years. Like I said, these equations are hyperbolic in nature, and another area where you encounter these hyperbolic equations are gas dynamics or compressible flows, right? Dr. Murli had talked about this briefly in his lecture, and he, in fact, he had mentioned that the techniques used in gas dynamics can carry over to shallow water equations. So these are based on something called Godunov solvers or Godunov methods, and one kind of Godunov method is called a Riemann solver, right? This kind of method can be used for solving shallow water equations, right? So tidal, or the original tidal model had was based on this logic. Now we have been developing a newer solver for tidal based on this Riemann solver or Godunov solver. So soon both will be available as part of tidal. Right. the version that you have currently is based on this original method. So it is limited to structured grids. But the newer method or the newer solver will be releasing soon will have the Riemann solver and can accept any kind of unstructured grid. Right. So I'll skip this part for now. And just briefly, I'll say some auxiliary things or additional quantities that you can specify while solving the shallow water equations. You can consider the daily diurnal tides, right? The tide at any location. And there are some analytical formulations or harmonic type equations based on sine cos. To tell you what will be the wave height at any particular location at any time during the day. It's based on the latitude of that position of that place and so on, right? Or you will even have coastal stations run by governments which have a record of the tides at those locations. So you can specify tides. So what happens typically in tsunami calculations is we assume that the earth, the wave or the ocean surface is completely flat, right? Which is not true because there is usually a daily tide at any time, right? But what we are interested more in is what is the wave height caused by the tsunami alone, right? So typically we ignore the tides and only consider a flat calm surface on which a tsunami is propagating, right? Now we consider tides, some additional complications happen. Let's see, maybe we'll discuss it in a little bit. You can have the bottom friction coefficient, which is like the roughness in your open channel hydraulics. And if you remember open channel hydraulics, there are two formulations for bottom roughness or roughness. One called the Manning coefficient, and one called the another one called the Chesi formulation, right? So this is based on the Manning. And this is based on the Chesi formulation, right? And typically, what you do is you don't specify the CF1 and CF2; you specify just this ratio, right? In input as a Manning coefficient, as a single number, right? For Chesi, since these occur. Because this here it occurs as a ratio, so you can just do the take the ratio and specify one number. Here they appear separately, and it's not easy to combine them. So when you're specifying the Chesi formulation, you specify two different numbers: the Chesi coefficient 1 and 2.
These are empirical relations, right?
Correct. Correct. Yeah, these are not just empirical relations. These cannot possibly be measured with any amount of accuracy. This is not going to be a single number, but typically you just take it as a single number, right? The earth is so big and the bottom surface is varying very, very rapidly and there's no pattern to how the bottom surface of the oceans change. And so you would imagine that the roughness will be different at different locations, but there is no way to measure this, and so typically we'll just assume some number, right? Like typically it's assumed to be some 0.0025 or something like that, right?
Is there a particular range?
Maybe it goes from 0.0025 to 0.01 maybe, but this is we have taken part in some exercises with some DAE organizations like PARC and IGCAR. Typically, this is the number they ask us to use, right? So pretty much in all our simulations, this is the number that we use. But you will, and I don't even know if different scientists, or modelers agree on a single number for this. Right? Different countries or different agencies might have their own preference for this number. So That's just a long way to say I'm not sure.
Does it need the fine tuning in your simulations?
No, there's only one now, one number that we use. We did do some sensitivity study. We were doing some work for BARC, Bhabha Atomic Research Center. So at that point, we did do a little bit of a sensitivity study to see how the wave heights would change with the bottom friction coefficient. We didn't see that much difference, right? Even when we changed it by almost one order of magnitude. But it could be for that particular problem, that particular set of conditions. For some other set of conditions, it could have a non-trivial effect. But in our experience, we haven't seen that much effect of this bottom friction coefficient. Please go ahead.
Sir, in the governing equation, there was a W with the CW part. So that correct. W is basically
the wind stress coefficient. So this is the coefficient which comes in due to the wind. Right.
Okay. But what is that W parameter?
Is the wind speed.
Of velocity?
Wind speed.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Right. And now this W could change, be different at different places. So this could be spatially varying.
And in the convected part, we are neglecting that W part.
Yeah, because we have done the integration in the vertical direction, right? These are only vertically integrated shallow water equations, right? In this part, there is no d by dz of HW, right? That HW has come into the right hand side and has been integrated as a vertical mass flux.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay.
One question though. This
W has nothing to do with the your vertical velocity in Z direction. This W is only the wind speed, I understand.
W is just the wind speed. Yes, this is just the wind speed.
Yeah, this is nothing. I think no one should get confused this with.
You can see that's why we have used capital U, capital V. Right. If we do, so the small W is the wind speed. Yeah, someone else had a question, so please go ahead.
Yes, Manning coefficient and bottom friction coefficients are same.
So we use Manning friction Manning coefficient to specify the bottom friction coefficient. Yes.
No, are they same or they have a relation?
As far as I know, they are the same, right? This is CF here is computed is what we specify as the Manning coefficient.
Yeah, the value is 0.0025.
That is what we typically use.
Manning coefficient. Yes.
Correct.
Okay.
Okay. So now, how do you carry out a simulation? First, you identify your domain of interest, right? So for example, let's say you have India here, right? You have the land starts here, and then you have Sri Lanka here, so for example, and then you have Bangladesh and all, and maybe Indonesia here, and Andaman Islands here, and Lakshadweep here, and so on, and Africa far away. So for example, you have a tsunami earthquake happening here, right? So your domain of interest may be something like this, right? You cover a little further. Maybe I have a map here, I'll show it. But you need to cover enough of the area of interest. So for example, I may be interested in what are the wave heights, for example, at Trombay. Or some other sites on the Ratnagiri, or here Kalpakkam, Kodankulam, Vishakhapatnam, and places like Patisonapur and things like that, right? There are some places where the Department of Atomic Energy has sites or are interested in some sites. So those may be our interest. So if you're interested in India, you might consider this as our domain of interest.
Is there any thumb rule for choosing the domain?
No, there is no thumb rule, right? I'll come to this in a little bit, but what happens typically is when the tsunami waves come in, these boundaries are free open boundaries, right? Or what are called non-reflecting boundaries. So any wave that approaches here just passes without reflection, right? And we are not interested. So the entire thing gets over in a few hours. Even if the wave, even if you have Africa here, and the wave reflects and comes back, by the time it comes back to hit the Indian coast, the magnitudes might be diminished, and it might be a very, very long time. It may take another 20 hours or so for it to hit the African coast and come back to India. By the time, most of the disturbance would have died down, and the wave heights might be very, very less. So we don't consider, so the where you put the boundaries is not that important. You just need to make sure you cover all your places of interest. For example, if I'm interested in what is the wave height here, right, for some reason, then I have to make sure my boundary is beyond this, right? My boundary cannot be here, right? So only to that extent you need to consider what is your domain boundaries. Now, it looks very easy to say this is my boundary, but this may be up to 4,000 kilometers in size in each direction or more, right? So one of the simulations or some of the simulations we've done, the domain was like 4,500 kilometers by 4,500 kilometers, right? And the grid had many millions of cells, right? So first you have to identify your domain of interest, right? Then the most critical input data is your bathymetry, right? Because like I said, the bathymetry decides how fast the tsunami propagates and in which direction it propagates and so on, right? So without, so you need, the bathymetry data may not be, you could have some error in the deep sea, right? A few percent error won't cause that much of an issue. But especially near the land, where you're interested in how far into the land the water comes in and what is the water height and so on, you need the data to be very, very accurate, right? You may need the data to be of maybe 5 or 10 meter resolution. That is one data point every 5 meters or so, right? And that is usually very, very difficult to get. It may, and it's first thing, it's not publicly available. Even if you want to get the data, it might be very expensive to purchase, right? So this bathymetry data is very critical. But the other problem is there are a lot of errors, right? What typically happens is what's publicly available may not be from one source, right? Some of it may come from some satellite survey. Some of it may come from another satellite survey, and they may not be all carried out in the same year or the same month. So the scientists who work on this come up with some statistical methods to blend data from different sources. That may cause some error, right? So we have to be aware of that. Like I said, this may not be an issue away from the coast, but quite close to the coast, this is very, very important. The third thing you need is what is the initial surface disturbance, right? Whether it's caused. Yes.
I wanted to ask one thing.
Yeah.
How well does the structured grid model these surfaces, basically near the coast and all? As you know, the this bathymetry data also, it is very rough surface, it will be in many areas.
Right.
So you'll be having a lot of irregularities.
Correct.
So, this is structured grid. How well does it capture that?
So that is one of the reasons why we moved to the, or we have developed the Riemann solver method, because that can accommodate unstructured grids, right? Like I said, the structured grid is fine as long as you're only interested in propagation, right? And for the, all the others who may not be aware of it, we'll come to that in the next next few slides. What is propagation? What is runup? Right? But you are correct. If you want to accurately capture the runup and inundation, structured grid might not be very very good. But we have one thing that we did in some of our work for DAE, I'll show it. We did a local refinement, right? The grid can still be structured, but you can do clustering, like we did for the problem yesterday. Remember, we did the buildings for the atmospheric dispersion problem. Mm-hmm. We did some grid clustering. So like, you could do something like that in, for example, if I'm interested only in Kalpakkam, right? I will put a small area of 5 kilometer by 5 kilometer or something, and do a very refined grid at that area of 50 meter or 100 meter size. And at other places, it might be much, much, much larger.
And typically, like what are the number of cells you deal with for solving
these kind of problems? The maximum we have gone up to is about 3 million.
3 million?
Yes. But typically, the once we do local refinement, that is the area that we are most interested in. For those kind of simulations, we typically have 1.2 to 1.5 million cells.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. So next is we need where the disturbance occurs. And now you can see when an earthquake occurs, the what happens is you have a bottom surface like this and the top surface like this. The surface, so there are what are called plates, right? There are, so the earth, the continents are sitting on top of what are called plates, right? So there are different plates, and this plate could move on top of this plate, or this plate could, there could be another part of this plate, and this could move on top of this. So this is what causes the water surface to change. This doesn't happen instantaneously. It takes a few seconds to a few minutes to happen. But we usually neglect this. We assume whatever disturbance happens instantaneously everywhere. And the disturbance is not localized. It's not like a few meters or a few kilometers. The sea surface disturbance happens over many thousands of kilometers or many thousands of square kilometers. So I'll show an example in a subsequent slide. Right. So once you have the domain of interest, the bathymetry, the initial water surface disturbance, then you carry out what is called propagation and runup. Right. We already saw what was runup, which is basically what happens on the land. But before we come to the land, we have to see what happens in the sea, and that part is called propagation, right? So there are two phases typically in tsunami modeling, propagation and runup, right? The as far as our model is concerned, code tidal is concerned, it's all carried out seamlessly in one solver. There is no two steps, right? The solver automatically recognizes when the wave is in sea and when it is in land, and adjusts what it has to do. But propagation phase is basically what happens after the initial disturbance, and the waves travel outwards from the disturbance. And if the disturbance has happened at deep sea, the flow speeds could be very, very large due to large depth. And the waves undergo what is called refraction and diffraction. And for this condition where the wave is traveling in the deep sea, the shallow water equation can even be there's something called linearized shallow water equations. Even those are sufficient to accurately capture what is happening. And so the advantage is you can have very large grid size and you can have very large time steps. Okay, so we'll see how the waves, grid size and time step are related. This is similar to the Courant number or CFL condition that Dr. Dalal, I think, discussed on the first day, right? Now, once you come close to the surface and onto the, when the water goes onto the shore, the tsunami speeds are, the water speeds or wave speeds are very low, but the water level can rise very, very quickly, right? So in the deep sea, the tsunamis travel at very large speeds, but the wave heights are very low, right? Even if even for the 2004 tsunami, when the wave is traveling in the Indian Ocean, somewhere far away from the Indian coast, the wave heights might just be half a meter or 1 meter at the most, right? But it's only once it's so, for example, in Indonesia, somewhere here, as the wave is coming in here to approaching the Indian coast, here the wave heights may just be 0.5 meters. But they're traveling at very, very high speeds, right? 800 kilometers per hour. But once they come close to these Indian coast, for example, the wave heights increase very rapidly, right? For example, let's say this is the shore somewhere. The wave height is something like this here, and suddenly it could shoot up and come onto the land. Right here, it may be 0.5 meters. By the time it comes here, it could be maybe 10 meters. Right? So that is the danger associated with tsunamis. Right? So the water level rises very rapidly and to a great extent. And you need to make sure you use the full linear shallow water equations. And they're very, and like Dr. Datta, I think, said, you need to have a very fine grid to capture the run up very accurately. And because of that, and because an explicit scheme is used for capturing that run up, there are very severe time step limitations. Right. Now, once you go to that Riemann solver, Gordner solver based approach, these are somewhat, you can manage this better because the entire thing is done in a consistent manner or in the same manner. And the time step limitations, even though they are there, but they're not as severe, right? Now, so like I said, the time step is limited by the wave speeds. And like we saw, the wave speed is square root of GH, right? So you have time step limited by something like this, right? So this is the maximum time step you can get away with for that staggered grid kind of code. And like I said, when you have the boundaries, for example, this is India, let's say this is deep in the Indian Ocean or Arabian Sea, and this is the Indian Ocean, and the waves are traveling like this, you let the wave pass, right? So this is something called a radiation boundary condition or a non-reflection boundary condition. So what you do is at this, whatever is the wave height, the normal velocity to this boundary is set as this number, right? Where eta is the wave height and capital H is the water depth, right? So this is used to calculate the velocity and set the boundary condition. So this is dynamically changing boundary condition. So this is called a radiation boundary condition. Okay, so now what are the required data? Like I said, bathymetry, initial disturbance, and tide, wind, so, and bottom.
Rajagopalji, just that initial conditions only needed for water surface disturbance, not for UV?
Typically not. Typically, they are not needed for UV. It's only for the water height. Correct. Okay. So, what is bathymetry? Right? Bathymetry is basically the depth of water at any location, right? And this plays an important role in determining the response to any disturbance. The wave speeds are related to the water depth. There's publicly available data, I'm sure from a lot of other sources, but one of the most important or best sources is some US government agencies. One is the US Geological Survey, and another one is the US National Oceanographic Agency. They have something called a JEPCO data that you can download, which is 1 kilometer resolution. They also have something called satellite radio tomography or something like that, which is much finer, which is you have one data point for every 30 meters. Right? So some of this data you can download for the entire flow. Right. So this is what the, so I've just plotted the contours of the depth. Right. I've not plotted it on the land, because this, for these kind of simulations, this whatever is in the land is completely useless for shallow water equation, because wave is not going to go into land. It, at best, it might go half a kilometer or 1 kilometer into the land. So this entire part, everything outside this red line, you can just completely delete. Any cells there, you can just delete. Maybe even find it. So this, what we are interested in is in the only the ocean and just a little bit of the land, maybe 1 or 2 kilometers at best. And so you can see in the Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean, the depth is not that much, right? Maybe 2,000 or 3,000 meters, right? It's only when you go slightly further away from the Indian continent here, by the time we come here, it's about 4,000 meters. The depth is very, very high once you go beyond Indonesia, right? Here is where you get 6,000, 7,000 meters and so on. But otherwise, the depths here are very slow. Now, even more interestingly, what you can see is once you get close to this coast of Bengal and Bangladesh, the water depth gets very, very shallow, right? So the tsunamis, any tsunami waves that come from here, they travel very slowly here. So, for example, the distance between this point to here, maybe 3,000 or 4,000 kilometers, or maybe 2,000 kilometers, let's say, and this is about 3,000 kilometers. But the tsunami from here to here will reach in about 2.5 hours, right? But for it to reach this, some places in Bengal, it might take 7 to 8 hours, right? So this is maybe, let's say I said 2,000 to 3,000 kilometers, and this is about 3,500 kilometers, let's say. So even though the distance is maybe only 20-30% higher, it takes 2 or 3 times the time to reach it, because once it gets into this very shallow part, the waves travel very, very slow. Right. So the wave heights may not be also that much high, because there are some mangroves and so on which offer natural protection in this part. So those may be some good areas to locate nuclear power plants if they are on the seashore. And to come to Dr. Datta's question about having refined grid near the surface, so this is some simulation we are doing, and we have already done using the Riemann solver. So we did some refinement, because we are doing some parametric study. So this refinement was not exactly on the land, but some part of the refinement covers the land. Right? This is in the sea. So you can see, so this is some one of the things that you could do.
But Riemann solver, you said you are using for unstructured grid, right?
Yeah, this is an unstructured grid, right? This is the elements are all quad elements, but this is an unstructured grid.
Oh, it's unstructured grid. It is right. Looking like steps like that. No?
Correct, but you can see that this one cell is connected to two cells on this side, right? So this is no longer a structured grid, right? This kind of a grid, in our terminology, we call this a split structured grid, because it's maybe structured in this locally, this area, but overall, when you consider the entire grid, this is no longer structured. Now, as you can see, like Dr. Datta was saying, coast is not captured very well if you have a structured grid and the grid size is very large, right? This looks very, very jagged.
Right.
So this is not very ideal if you want to capture run up on the land, right? If you want to do that, you will have to have this kind of a grid here, right? This is very, very dense. You can't even see the individual cells. So you need to have something like this here.
I'm asking if you are, for example, using something like a triangular grid or something.
Yeah, we can use triangular grid also. The Riemann solver allows any kind of a grid.
Yeah, in that case, you will not have any steps. You will be able to...
Yeah, we can capture it much better.
The boundary exactly as it is.
Now, again, even if it's triangular element, it depends on the size of the triangular element. Even then, your grid might be It might not be jagged like this, but it might not be very smooth.
Right.
Instead of going like this, it could go like this. It might not be the smoothest grit, right? So there may be some roughness in your grit, but you can get away with by once you do some grid refinement. But as long as the edges of the cells are straight lines, the coast will not be exactly smooth. Like a nice continuous polynomial curve.
How much was the difference in results by refining these grids compared to?
We will get back to you on that. Certainly, the run-up and inundation we can capture much better, right? The accuracy is far better. So, in terms of the wave heights, there is some difference. But give us a little bit more time. We will do some more study and we'll get back to you.
Okay.
The next input that you require is the initial water height, like I said. And these are the major tsunami or the earthquake zones around India. And these are potentially the these numbers represent the maximum earthquake magnitudes that scientists think can happen in these areas. So the most important area for India is Andaman and this area called Sunda, right? This is Sunda is next to Indonesia. So this is called the Sunda Arc. So this and Indonesia and maybe a little bit of Burma and Bangladesh. These are important for the sites or the east coast of India. For the west coast, there is an area called Makran, which is off the coast of Iran, which is important. Again, even on the west coast, the water depths are somewhat shallow, and you can't expect very high tsunami wave heights on the west coast, at least from our limited experience. We are certainly not experts in this area, but at least based on the simulations we have done, the wave heights are not that high on the west coast. Due to earthquakes, for example, in Andaman or Indonesia, you could have wave heights of 5, 6, or 7 meters in some of these east coast areas, maybe even higher. But due to this earthquake and by the time this comes to, for example, Trombay in Maharashtra, the wave heights may be like 0.5 meters or less, right? But due to this earthquake in off the coast of Iran, by the time this comes here it may cost maybe 1.5 meters. Again, these are just rough numbers. From what I understand, the last earthquake which caused any significant wave to come to Bombay from Makran was in 1941 or something like that. And this data was, this map and these data were shared by Dr. Roshan at AERB in Bombay, Atomic Energy Regulatory Board. So, he was our contact and PC for a project that we did with DAE. And so we're thankful to him for this data. Now, so one thing is where the earthquake is located. Next is, how does the earthquake or the fault affect the initial water height, right? So the key parameters here are where is the earthquake or the earthquake epicenter, and what is the strength of the earthquake or the magnitude of the earthquake, and what is the direction in which it is oriented. So for example, there could be an earthquake here and which is oriented like this. It could still cause some water heights here, right? But if the earthquake, the fault direction is like something like this, then most of the waves will go in this direction. Right? There may still be some effect here, but not that much. So this orientation of the fault is very, very important. Right? Again, these are, you can see these happen deep under the earth, and it's not possible to estimate them exactly. So I'm just giving you a very rough overview of what are the things involved. And once you have the earthquake magnitude, the amount of water that is displayed and maximum water height, initial water height, are all computed based on the energy. So the amount of displacement is related to what is the overall energy, and that is related to what is called the slip, or the amount, the maximum water height you will experience. So these are all based on a lot of empirical formula. So this is one such empirical formula. So given some magnitude m naught, it's converted into something called moment magnitude, and from that, this is the size of the fault, the length and the width, and the slip is the amount of water height rise. So these are all various empirical formulas. Now, so what happens is, so you can think of this as a fault which is causing the, so you can say there is a fault here of, let's say, 1000 kilometer length and 100 kilometer width, and it rises by 10 meters here. So this will cause a 10 meter rise in the water surface. So this is how these things are roughly used. Now, it's not used exactly like that. So what happens is, I'll show you. So due to this earthquake, the fault changing, so this is the initial water height contour. So this is at time equals zero. This is for the 2004 earthquake. Right? So this is one of the initial conditions. So right next to Indonesia here, the water surface has gone above the initial level, the flat level, by almost 9 meters. So what happens is, when water, so water level goes up at some point, in some other point the water level has to go down, right? So you can see here it's in blue color. So the water level, initial water level, has gone down. So what happens? So you have the surface of the bottom surface. So if the water surface goes up here, it goes down like this at some point. So what this water can come in here, and this water can go like this. So this is how the tsunami starts. So this is a typical initial condition, right? And this is so this is a simulation we did for the 2004 tsunami, one of the scenarios. This is the wave heights after 1 hour, right? So you can see, even though the wave might have been initially spherical, but after some time you can see it becoming more like an ellipse and going outwards. You can see some wave going towards this side, and at this point you can still see the maximum wave height is in this side is maybe one meter or so. And here this is light yellow color, it's maybe 0.4 or 0.5. So like I said, in the deep sea, the wave heights may not be that much. Now you can see this wave could immediately go and hit the Indonesian coast in Banda Aceh and so on. And here they experience wave heights of more than 20 meters once it hit the land. So the run up here at some places was 20 meters. And this is something called directivity map. Right, so this is what this is after you have done the simulation for whatever 10 hours or something like that, you have a grid like this, right, and so on. So in every cell you go and find out what is the maximum wave height in that 10 hours, right? So let's say at this cell the maximum wave height reached at some point was 3.77. This could have been happened at time equals 2 hours after the earthquake started. Now here, at some other cell here, close to the Indian coast, the maximum wave height here is maybe only 2.5 meters. Right? And this could have happened at some other time at 3.5 hours. But no matter at which time it happened, you just go and find out what is the maximum wave height at any cell, at any point during the simulation, and you plot contour of that. And this tells you roughly in which direction most of the energy was directed. So this is called a directivity map. And this could be different for different tsunamis and different orientations. So we, one of the simulations that we did for the 2004 tsunami, there is some tidal gauge data available for Visakhapatnam. So this was our simulation, there's some data missing in the observed data. So either the wave heights became very high and it failed, or something else happened and there was some missing data. But once you plot this, this looks like a decent comparison. This was actually shared. So this, we did this part of the simulation and we shared it with BARC. The chief seismologist at BARC, Dr. at that time, 2009 or 10, Dr. G.J. Nair, unfortunately passed away at some point later. He did a comparison of our data and the observed data. So we were able to predict reasonably well the time at which the first tsunami waves appear. So that's called the arrival time. So you can see this is when you get some first significant peak, right? So at any coastal location, this is called the arrival time. So this is important. So this gives you how much time is available for you to prepare and warn your and make arrangements, right? Coming to storm surges can also be modeled using shallow water equations. So what we need is we need to come up with some model to give the wind speed given the properties of the hurricane, right? Now the hurricane or the storm rotates about an eye and causes like a vortex kind of motion in the atmosphere, and you get a similar pattern of wind speeds close to the wind surface or the sea surface. So as you move away from the center, the wind speeds could increase, right? But the thing is, the location or the center of the storm or the hurricane is moving, right? So for example, you could have a rotating motion like this where the center is here. After some 10 hours, it could have moved somewhere here, and it could have changed in strength, and it could have weakened or increased in strength, but this eye has moved to some other point, right? So these are things that you have to consider. So in Tidal, we have Dr. Ranchal, our founder, he put in this model called the Holland model from 2010. So this is the, at any location, this is the speed at the surface level. And let me just share our manual. I'm not entirely sure of what all these parameters mean. Give me a second and share a different document. Let me know once you're able to see my screen now. Can you see my screen now? Hello?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. Document is visible.
Okay. Sure. Okay. So you can see this VS is here is the surface speed, right? Now there are various parameters which describe the storm properties or the storm shape and what is the pressure drop and external pressure. And where is the storm located, the latitude at which the storm is located, what is this, like I said, the storm I could be moving, so what is the speed at which it's moving and in which direction it is moving, right? What is the surface moisture level, humidity, and surface temperature, radius at which the maximum winds are to be expected. So what happens is, see if I can write. So based on the distance, this is the distance and this is the speed from the eye, the wind speed is not increasing with radius or decreasing. it increases up to a point, and then after some point it decreases and so on. So there's at some location where it reaches the maximum speed. So from the center, since the storm we assume is in circular shape, so the radius at which the maximum speed occurs is also one of the inputs, and this is the sea surface temperature and so on. So these are various parameters you can give to estimate, get an estimate of the sea surface temperature, sea surface winds, and use it to compute the effect or the contribution of the wind, surface winds, to the momentum equations. Let's stop sharing this thing.
So in this Prajapati, I
have yes. Yeah.
So when you were solving a storm surge problem, so along with the momentum equation, the momentum equation term, that wind speed is coming as a variable.
Correct. Correct.
So for this wind speed, you are solving a different equation.
This is not a different. This is not a different equation. This is a known algebraic formula. So this is like an empirical formula.
Okay. So that means the wind speed will be varying with time and space.
Correct. So correct. Yes. It will be. Yes.
That information you will be getting to in a momentum equation.
Correct. Correct. Yes. Now let me just share this again, because I just want to point out a couple of things in that. So the things that you could specify include whether the storm is rotating in the clockwise or anti-clockwise direction, so that you're telling the solver whether it's in the southern or the northern hemisphere. What is the latitude? The sea surface temperature you can specify. I think there are some default values for some of these things, but you can specify the temperature, the density, the external pressure, the center pressure, the location at which the maximum wind speed occurs, and the pressure drop, and so on. So these are various things that you can specify to the solver. So for example, you can say the external pressure is this much, the critical pressure, the pressure drop. This is as a function of time. So how the storm could be increasing in pressure or decreasing in rates. It's most dangerous when there's a very low pressure at the center. So once as the pressure increases at the center, the storm strength reduces. And so I believe this number is given in kilometers. So 20 kilometers from the center of the storm is where it reaches the maximum, and so on. So these are various input that you can give to the solver. Okay, so I think I'll stop here for now, because we're almost at 4:45. So we'll see. We can try to quickly do one case. Dr. Datta and your colleagues, if you're interested in this storm surge and other things, yes. We can set up a meeting next week, right? And we can discuss that. You have my email. You can. Contact me anytime, or you can share your email. We can get in touch.
Yeah, we look interested.
So the hands-on exercise we'll do is based on a real life tsunami. In 1993, there was an earthquake which hit the Hokkaido island in the Hokkaido area in Japan. One of the islands called Okushiri was hit, and there one of the villages was washed away. So in 2004, the Japanese government and some of the US agencies, they set up an experiment in a lab. They reproduced the topography of the sea and the land very accurately up to a certain distance. And they had some information about the wave heights away from the shore. And so they used this to reproduce this in a lab, right? And they used wave makers to produce the reproduce the waves. And so this is a 3D model of the so this is the water surface or the water depth, the bottom of the surface, sea surface next to the island. This is a 3D model of the land here, and there is a small hill under the water at one of the near the coast. And so the wave comes in this direction, and once it reaches close to the sea shore, it rises and then floods onto the land. So they did this experiment in lab, and they put a number of sensors at places like this, right? At some 10 to 20 places, if I remember correctly, they put sensors and measured the water height very precisely. And so there are some of this data is available publicly. So this is one of the standard cases used for doing benchmark studies or validation studies for shallow water codes. So we will, so, and this is the pattern of the waves. For example, so this is our domain, right? So the island is located, the land is located somewhere here. This part and this part, we'll assume they are solid, like a channel, right? So wave comes in from this side. So at this boundary, we will specify a time varying wave, and the amplitude of the wave is given by this. And so there, I have downloaded some data from one of the online sources, and I have sent it to everyone. If you have not downloaded, can you check your email? And you should be, you should have got an email during lunchtime. So can you download and unzip or extract the files in that in the file that I sent?
Here, what we have to do?
Just a second. I'll tell you. Just give me a second.
We have unloaded, downloaded those files into a folder.
Let me know. Just give me a second. I'll share my screen and then I'll tell you what we want to do. Now I've shared my entire screen. Let me know if you, once you can see it. Are you able to see my screen?
Not yet. Yeah, we are able to see your screen, but not your presentation.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. If you have downloaded the file I sent you, you unzipped it, you will see five files in that. Let me know if you're not able to see this.
Yes, sir, there are five files.
Right. So this there's a file called bathymetry.txt. This is the data available from the online source. This is the data used for all the verification. So this is, you can think of this as X, Y, and depth, right? At any point. Second is they have given the bathymetry also in some format, right? This is not the bathymetry. This is the time versus wave height on that boundary, on the west boundary. Right? I showed you the boundary here. So on this boundary, this is the time versus. So you can see at about 10, let's say, about 12 seconds or so, it reaches the maximum. So you can see So it, about 12 seconds, you can see the wave height is about 1.6 centimeters or so. So this is this data. So we will use this data also. Let us, can you go to your Tidal folder, or on your desktop you should have the Tidal icon. Can you start that? So can you start CFD Studio Tidal?
Yes.
Just give me a second. So select new project.
First option.
Second option, new project. And click on go. Now I must tell you, a lot of the most time spent instead doing a one of these simulations is taken up in the data preparation, preparing the bathymetry and the initial condition. I'm not showing you that step right now, right? I've already prepared the data for this particular simulation because that we may not have enough time to do that, go through that entire exercise. Okay, let us give a name for this project. Let us call it Monai Valley. Make sure I don't have a project of the same name. Yeah, I do. So I'll call this Monai Valley Tsunami. Now you can see in Tidal, as opposed to Answer or Poreflow that Mr. Chakrapani showed you yesterday, today, there is no option to select 3D, right? Because we are only doing depth averaged 2D simulations. Tidal does allow for 3D, but it is specialized and it's based upon some prior agreements with clients. So, but it is possible to do 3D shallow water simulations, but the version that you have, it's we can do 2D simulation. So click next. For this particular problem, we will do the grid is a uniform structured grid. So we can quickly do that grid using this simple shapes option. So click on this simple shapes. And here select box orthogonal grid. Now if anyone is lagging behind me where I am, please stop me. I'll go back or I'll repeat what I'm doing. Otherwise, I'll go to the next step. So select this box orthogonal grid option. And okay. Now the length of the domain is, the bottom left coordinate will be 0, 0. The top right coordinate or the length of the domain is 5.448 meters. Remember, this was a lab experiment. So we are reproducing that. This is 5.448. And this is 3.402. Now the number of nodes I max is 391. The number of nodes J max is 245. Okay. So now click finish. So this is an unsteady problem. So select unsteady and click on apply. Okay. We will create a few regions for the purpose of comparison. I said they had put some, when they did the experiment, they put some sensors to capture the wave heights. So we will also define a few locations where we want the output. So for this purpose, you will see an option here under create new region called a given location as station. So what you can do is, we can give a particular XY location And whichever cell that XY location falls in will be considered the region. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The seventh button from the top, given location as station. So the first station there was, we'll use a CH5. This is the label used by the experimentalist. So we'll use the same label, CH5. For this, the X coordinate is 4.521. And the Y coordinate is 1.196. Click on create. Okay, next we will define one more location. So click on this given location as station button again. Now give the name CH7. For this, the X coordinate is 4.521 again. The Y coordinate is 1.696, and click on create. Again, if anyone has any questions or any doubts, do stop me by coming on, unmuting yourself. Now click on this given location station one last time. We'll define a third location. Let's call it CH9. I think CH stands for channel, so channel 5, 7, and 9. The X coordinate again is 4.521. And the Y coordinate is 2.129. Click on create. So we are done with these regions. Click next.
Dr. Rajagopal,
yes.
Can you help me with those coordinates from beginning? I had some problem with my.
I will write the coordinates here. The first coordinate is.
Actually, I was not able to input the initial coordinates itself. There was some problem.
No, I'll tell you. So the first one is CH5. Yes.
No. I am in the beginning. Starting coordinate 0, 0, ending coordinate
5.448.
Yeah. Next one?
3.402.
5.402.
3.402.
3.402.
And the number of nodes I max is 391.
And having
J max is 245.
I max is how much? I max?
391. And J max is 245.
Okay. I'm facing some strange problem. I'm typing the numbers. Time to input it. J max is 241.
245.
One minute. Ending coordinate Y was. Please repeat the ending coordinate of Y.
3.402.
Okay. So now I will do finish, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Now under create new region, you select unsteady, unsteady, and press apply.
Yeah. Okay. Now
under
now,
create new region, you will have. Yes. Given location as station.
Given location. Okay. Yes.
Give the name CH5.
Small letters?
Doesn't matter.
Okay. Fine.
X coordinate 4.521. Y coordinate 1.196.
I coordinate 1.196
and click on create.
Yes.
click on that given location button again. This time change the name to CH7. Again, x coordinate is 4.521. And y coordinate is 1.696.
1.696. Create.
Click on create.
Yes.
Now do click on this given location as station option again for the last time.
Yeah.
Give the name CH9. And x coordinate again 4.521. Y coordinate 2.129. 2.129. And click on create.
Yes, I've done that.
Okay, fine. Now you can close. Then click on next.
Yeah.
Okay. So we will set the south, north, and the east boundaries to be walls. So click on this walls button.
Okay.
And under entire boundary, select the entire boundary option, the second option. And choose X plus.
Right.
Now click on the walls button again.
Here I will press apply.
Yes. Click on walls button again.
Yes, yes, done.
Under entire boundary, select entire boundary and choose Y minus. And click on apply.
Done.
Click walls again.
Yes.
This time choose Y plus and click on apply.
Done.
Okay. Click next.
Done.
Now we will set the boundary conditions. Okay. So click on the boundary conditions button.
Yes. Done.
Under the dependent variable, select eta. So we are setting the wave height. So select eta.
Right.
Under entire boundary, it should choose entire boundary and it should be X minus.
X minus. Okay.
Okay. Please go to other conditions.
Right.
You have an option before that. Yeah, it's fine. You have an option here which says get table from file.
Right. Select it.
And click on this > button. So this button opposite the get table from file.
Right.
From the data I sent to you, you will have a file called bathymetry 2 input, benchmark 2 input.txt.
To go to that folder.
You have to choose all types file. File correct. Type all file.
Yeah, under files of type, you can choose all types, yes.
Benchmark 2 input.txt, right?
Correct.
Which one? Benchmark 2. Okay.
Yes.
Right.
And click open.
Yes, done that. Done that.
Now, under you will see an option label here which says number of values. And there's a text box next to it. Enter the number 451. So basically, the text file has 451 values. So we have to mention that here.
Okay. Then
451. And yes. Click on apply. Now you can click on close. Yes. Okay. Now there is two ways to specify the bound the bathymetry. Just give me a second. Okay, forget it. Now you see under boundary conditions, you see a option called read previous solution.
Yeah.
Click on that.
Yes.
Select the first option, read generic archive file.
Right.
Click on this dot 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 button. Go to the data you downloaded, you will see a file called monai_depth.sav.
Okay. Open it.
Say open and click on apply.
Yes, done.
Click next.
Yes.
We don't have to specify any density. So click next. For this problem, we'll specify a bottom friction coefficient. To Dr. Dirbude's question, this was a benchmark problem in a 2004 workshop, and I think in that they did some parametric study, or they did the study for multiple values of bottom friction coefficient. So what you were saying, you had asked whether we should do like a series of simulations with different values. I think that they might have done it in this workshop, and so they specified that we use 0.02. So click on this bottom friction and wind stress coefficient specification button.
Right.
Here you will see specify bottom friction coefficient.
Okay.
So click on this button.
Uh-huh.
And let's use the Manning formula.
Right.
0.02 and 1. So basically the ratio is 0.02. Click on apply.
You want it to be 0.02 or 0.00?
0.02.
Then we can take the constant value as also 0.02.
The formulation might be different because the formula, as you saw, the way to calculate the CF is different.
Yeah. There was another formula,
right,
on the right hand
side. So for this, let's use the Manning formula, 0.02, and click on apply. And click close. Now click next.
Yeah.
Once you have the Riemann solver, you can go here to pick whether you want to use the Riemann solver option or whether you want to use the old algorithm. For now, we will skip that.
Excuse me. What about this? Your tidal input values?
Yeah, we have already done that as boundary condition. We have done that.
You've done that.
And I think for tsunami, we are not taking tidal values. We are taking tidal values for storm surge inputs.
Yeah, typically we don't specify any tides for tsunami computation. Now, there may be cases where you want to do that, but that's maybe outside the scope of this session. So click next. There are no sources or sinks. Click next. Now we have come to output options. Click on the solution file options.
Right.
Select customize solution file.
Right.
Under here, you can select eta. We don't want to. What you are interested more is the wave height. So click on eta and select the time interval option and give one. So it will write a solution after every 1 second.
Okay.
And click on apply. Okay, now we want to extract the time history output for those three locations we defined. So click on this advanced button. Under this, you have an option called time history of variables. So select a time history. So what you might have to do is you take your mouse key and go to the bottom left and pull it, make it a little wider and a little pull it down a little bit. Then at the top you will see an option to say which says select subregion. Can everyone see this option? Select subregion.
No, where it is?
No, you can. In this window, you just take your mouse to the bottom left and pull it down and to the right a little bit. Yeah, make it a little bigger.
Got it.
Okay. Yeah.
Now, first select the subregion CH5.
Okay.
Select under select variables, you just select eta.
Okay.
And under print frequency, it by default it is 20. You can change it to 1 and click on apply.
Yes.
Now click on time history again, time history of variables. This time choose the region CH7.
Right.
Okay, actually one thing we forgot to do. Okay, select CH5 again. Okay, select CH5. Let's give the let's change the file name here to ch5.his.
Where?
Here it says there's an option under select variables. It says file name for time history output.
Okay.
You can give it ch5.his or ch5.txt or something like that.
CH5.js.
Yes. So we know exactly what data is in that file. Okay. Now click apply. Select time history again. Now select the region CH7 and change the file name to CH7.his and click apply.
Yes.
Select it one last time, time history of variables. Select CH9. Yes. And change the file name as CH9. Mm-hmm. And click on apply.
Done.
Now close. Now click next. We won't set any convergence criteria or matrix solvers, so we'll leave it at the default values. And now we can click next. Under now click on the solve button.
Right.
So the benchmark data is available up to 25 seconds. So basically what they did is they from 0 to 25 seconds, they had some input from the wave maker. Then they stopped the wave maker and whatever wave was already generated inside the tank, they let it reflect and all, so on. And then it left out from where the boundary came out. So the data is available up to 50 or 60 seconds. But for the second half, we have to set the boundary to be non-reflecting or non-radiating. So we'll just do for the first 25 seconds. So under time period for solution, change it to 25. And change the time step to 0.001. And click on apply. Now, if you're
time period is
25. And the time step is 0.001.
What about static variable?
Excuse me. You don't have to select the variables. It automatically knows what variables to solve.
Done.
Now click on apply.
Done.
And finish.
Okay.
There's one item that I think I forgot to mention. Go to this shortcut commands.
Will not save the project yet. It's asking for saving your current
project. Yeah, you can save the project. Please save the project.
We say yes.
Yes. Yeah. Play. Say yes. Click on yes. Now under shortcut to commands, you scroll down, you will see gravity. Can you select this gravity? Click on gravity. You can see the shortcut to commands on the top left or below the file edit options. There's a small box with an arrow, which is shortcut to commands. You click on that and you will see every command that we have done through the wizard can also be done from here.
One minute. I'm not able to look at that. Under the file, you have this.
Click on this.
Yeah. Okay. Shortcut to command.
You go down, you will see gravity.
Gravity.
Okay.
Yes. Select that. We'll select that.
Just a second. Yeah, select gravity.
Yeah.
Select absolute value of gravity is 9.821, I think.
Where to make it, where to type that 9.81?
Yes. Actually, type that and press OK or press apply.
But why you need to do that? Because it will take x square plus y square root of that, no?
I just want to specify one number here. So, okay, you can just delete it and just say gravity 9.81.
Well, means under your absolute value?
No. You can just leave it at 0 and minus 9.81. Click on apply.
Yeah, it is all right. It will take the absolute
value. Now please come to the input file here. It says it must say for you 0 and minus 9.81. Just delete the 0 and delete the minus sign. Just say gravity 9.81.
In the commands file, no?
Yes, correct. You can just use your keyboard to just delete the 0 and the minus sign.
We can delete that from the commands file, gravity.
No, not the entire thing. Just delete the 0 in the gravity command. Delete the 0 and the minus sign. Okay. You can see I have highlighted it here in my window.
Yeah. Okay.
Once you have made this change, just click on this button to save it. The top.
One minute. You have made the gravity there 9.81, is it?
Yes.
Full screen. Okay, so you have to make it 9.81.
And click on this button to save the changes.
Where is save the changes button?
At the top under file, you have a series of buttons. The fourth button, there is a floppy disk icon.
Okay.
Click it once and it will save the changes we made.
Save project option, no?
Yes. Okay, now you can click on the run project button. It might take about 5 to 10 minutes, I guess, for about 5 minutes for the simulation to finish.
In the meantime, I'll just ask you some questions, general question about this. See, in this kind of problems, like tsunami problems, it's a dynamic problem. So, like over a period of time. So here, basically, we are only solving the wave equation. But the, is there any effect of temperature on this? Like, for example, like over a period of, let's say, 10 hours to one day, the seawater temperature will change. So,
Does
that have any effect on density?
No, we have not. As far as I know, that is not taken into account.
That doesn't have much effect on this.
No.
Okay, because as you know, there are some your atmospheric currents, etc., are there. Like within our your Earth's profile, no. So there are some currents, hot current, cold current, like that.
Okay.
So like within the sea, some temperature changes happen over a period of time.
Right. So, right.
Is that important for this kind of simulation? That's what I was asking.
Okay. I have to be honest. I don't think for tsunamis they make that much difference. Right? The density variations are not that that significant. Okay. So I don't think they make much difference for tsunami simulations.
They make difference for storm surge. There is a climate change paper by Dr. A.D. Rao of IIT Delhi,
mm-hmm.
on climate change, okay. and tsunamis in west coast of India.
Mm-hmm.
And we also have observed, in recent past, we had more frequencies of cyclones on the west coast.
Yeah,
certainly, if you see even that Holland model for storm surge, wind speeds, you can see there is a temperature dependence there. So the temperature will change the wind speeds significantly.
In cyclones, there is effect of temperature. I was asking for tsunami.
Yeah. Now, while the problem is running, this is a comparison I made of the CFD simulation with the observed data. The observed data is in green here, and the CFD simulation is in blue. You can see that the peak is reasonably well produced, and the time of peak also. But not every all the you can see the CFD simulation has some more oscillations. It's numerically not as stable. So maybe we have to use a smaller time step, or finer grid or something like that. If you're interested, or if any of the participants are interested, all the observed data is given in the, along with the files I sent you today. There'll be a file called measure.dat.
Okay.
You'll find it there. Maybe you can run the case with either a smaller time step or something like that. So, and check whether that improves the comparison.
How are you able to see this data in your graphical format?
I used a plotting tool called GNU plot to plot GNU.
But in your software, does it have any tool for plotting?
There is no XY plotter. No. So in the past, I had done this using Excel. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah, I can see.
So this is again the same comparison I had made in the past. I think this was done with Excel. I think this is location 5. This is 5, I think. And so again, these are the comparisons that we get.
So you're saying if you do it with more refined grids, then it's better. This one is with refined grid. The one on the right side.
All these are the same grids. These are three different points. They kind of look similar, but these are from the three different points. Point number 5, point number 7, point number 9. the comparison for the point number 5, point 5, location 5, location 7, and location 9. This is the exact same grid. Whatever we are using today, this simulation was also done with the same grid. Anyone has any questions here?
So what is the parameter in x and y coordinate in that
graph? In x direction is the time level. Y axis is the wave height at the eta at those points. So we are doing the simulation up to 25 seconds. And this is wave height in millimeter, I think. Centimeter, I'm sorry. This is wave height in centimeter.
Okay.
Again, like I said, this is a lab experiment where the depth, the entire dimension of the basin was about 5 meters by 3 meters, 5.5 meters by 3.5 meters, and the water depth was about 33 centimeters. And on top of that, they have about 4 to 5 centimeter water rise.
Your contour plot of the your profile at different times, whatever we are generating.
Yes. Yeah, we'll see that. We'll see that. Now, as the simulation is going on, you can go to CFD Studio. You can let's go back to CFD Studio.
Okay.
It must have already generated a few solution files. Can you under on the top menu, you have the visualize button.
Yes.
Click on the second option, load matching solution file.
Okay.
Click on this dot 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 button.
What is AV file?
Click on open that.
Yeah. Apply.
Yes. Next, first you turn off the grid, toggle the grid visibility off the this button here. So now you can see this button. The first, you can see where my cursor is.
1 minute. Okay.
And let us turn on the legend.
Turn on the legend.
Legend is this button on the right of the region names, the third button here.
Okay.
Click on it once. Yeah. When it looks like it's in the press state, you will see the legend here.
Yeah.
And the first button is the contour button. You can double click on it to open this dialog.
Double click. Yeah.
Okay. Now you can see at the this
window has come.
Yeah, you can see this. The same solution file has the solution for multiple time levels. So you can see this is the solution at contour at time equals 1. You can see the time here is 1.
Where the time is coming?
You can see on the top right corner of this contours dialog, you can see record properties.
Okay.
REC, step,
time,
step,
time, time. Yeah.
Time. Okay. Now, do you see a checkbox here which says show record name in variable name?
Yeah, right.
Check that checkbox.
Right.
Now you can see the numbers here. Eta colon 1. Under scalar variable.
Under scalar. Eta, yes.
Eta select colon that. 1. You click on that, you can see the number of eta 1, 2, 3, 4. I don't know how far it has finished for you.
1 minute. Number of eta's it is showing.
Correct. What is the last number you see? You can scroll down.
I'll click on that, Ita.
You can select the last one that you have. For me, it's far finished 14 seconds. So this is at time equals 14.
That Ita value. No, sir.
Under scalar variable, it will say eta colon 14 or eta colon 1, eta colon 2.
No. See, under colon, under scalar variable, one window is coming where it is showing eta. Hold on a minute, let me see.
So, you please see what I'm doing on my screen. Just come back to the Microsoft. Okay. Just wait a second. You select this option here, which says show record number. You put a tick mark there. You select it once, you will see a tick mark here.
1 second. Yeah, okay. Now that number is coming.
Yeah. So you can, I don't know how far it has finished for you. For me, it had finished 14. So I see up to eta colon 14. So this is the solution at time equals 14 seconds. So you can see the wave height.
Mine is showing eta colon 2 only.
Yeah, it's probably a little slower for you on your system. You can can you go back to this visualize solution? Okay, go back to visualize.
Right.
Select load matching solution.
Right.
And click on that dot dot and select that dot .sav file again.
Open it.
Click open. Now it will ask you whether to add or replace. Select replace.
It has not asked me anything. It had asked earlier. 1 minute. It is not asking that.
Okay. You said it previously asked you. I don't know. You might have selected add. So it doesn't ask you again.
Actually, I had selected earlier only when you had asked to do this, your visualization options change, contour and all that. Before that, only I had added it. So it is making the changes, but I can see the contour has changed.
Yeah, so you can see the time here, at which time it is plotting the solution.
So for that, I will be again going there, right?
Yes.
For seeing the time, I have to go to where? What you said just now?
So you can see here under record props, you can see record number, step number, and time.
You please repeat that command.
So can you please look at the teams so you can see what I'm doing?
Oh, 1 second. Okay, within contours, right? You're saying.
Yeah, under contours, you can see an option here. There's like a box here which says show record number in variable name.
Okay. Yeah, select. And now it is 14, ETA 14.
Yeah. So it is still ongoing for you. So you can look at 14 will look something like this.
Yeah, it is looking like this.
Okay. Now in Windows Explorer, let us go back to that folder where we are solving this problem. So you will see here three files, ch5.his, ch7.his, and ch9.his.
Within Windows folder, where we should look for it?
So wherever you stored the current project, whatever name you gave for the project, there'll be a folder under title projects.
One minute.
You have the title software. Under that, you'll see the folder title projects.
Right. Title projects.
And okay. You must have saved.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I've got that folder. Yeah.
Yeah, you will see the files ch5.his.
Yes, yes.
You can open it. You can see time versus eta at that location. Okay, so this is the CFD solution. The files I sent you earlier today, there's a file called measured.dat, which contains the experimental data. So we can compare these two. But just remember, under the measured data, they've given it in centimeter, but we are solving it in meter. So just either multiply the CFD solution by 100 or divide the experimental data by 100. So that you compare in the correct units. Any other question? Anyone has questions about what we did, or any part of it was you had any issues or doubts about? Okay, if not, I think I'll stop now. So I hope that gave you an idea of what kind of problems and what kind of problems we can solve with Tidal, and how we could go about solving it, and what kind of input is required for solving these kind of problems. I wish we had time. We could have done like a hypothetical tsunami around India. Because I wish we had time to do that also, so that you get an idea of how the tsunami propagation and run-up works. But I think we didn't have enough time to do that. So if you're interested in this problem, do contact me on email or something, and then we can see how to get you started on that. So I'll stop for now. Dr. Debude, you can take over.
Yeah, thank you, Rajagopalji. It was a really nice hands-on session. And I think this is the last hands-on session, and we'll be having tomorrow some case studies on physics-informed neural network. And tomorrow's session will be on smooth particle hydrodynamics, machine learning, and some other area of CFD related heat transfer, or even heat transfer and fluid mechanics related. So see you tomorrow at 9:30, and I close this session for today. Thanks for your patience and your presence. See you tomorrow at 9:30.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thanks to all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.